from the town with a great football team. We see the Pittsburgh Steelers winning the habit, not only a dream. Go out and get them, Steelers! Hey!
Yes, hello, welcome to episode 66 of the UK Steelers podcast. You're joined as always by me, Simon Stanley, and the three co-hosts, Gavin Marshall, Dave Hart, and Rich Cetrone. How are you doing, guys?
Yeah, not too bad. I've just had a sort of 45-minute long moan off from me pre-recording, so hopefully I can try and be a bit more positive now, even though maybe there's not that much to be positive about.
Well, let's see. Yeah, I sense that negativity might, you know, find its way through the show. But a few people have hit me up like over the last couple of weeks saying, like, stay negative because it's working. So I think the superstitious amongst us are going to enjoy this episode.
You mean they like it because it's bringing results, or they like it because it's a more entertaining show, or both?
I think mainly the results. I don't think anyone's parading around saying this is entertaining.
Okay. We're fooling no one, not even ourselves.
Dave, how's it going?
Yeah, I'm good. We're just, as I say, we've just been enjoying Gav's rant. So I'm ready to feel positive now, but I'm not there. I'm not there yet.
Okay, maybe we can turn things around. Rich, how's it going over there?
Doing good. Trying to put a positive spin on everything, so doing all right.
I'm looking forward to this. I can sense what's coming. I'll be honest. Despite the Steelers being 11-0 after a sloppy win over the Ravens practice squad, I am kind of bummed. I don't think there's any sense in burying the lead. We'll get to the game itself in a minute, but first things first, we need to talk about late in the game. Obviously, Bud Dupree's knee gives out. It's been confirmed it's a torn ACL, right? You'll miss the rest of the season. Maybe I'm jumping into this a bit too quick, but I think we need to get off this, you know, on the top of the show, because this is kind of the biggest news coming out of this game, right?
Yeah. I mean, I'm mainly bummed for him, actually.
Yeah.
What a bad time when he's right peak coming into the, you know, crunch time in the season, in a crunch time for his, you know, contract, you know, going forward and his position on the team. And then that happens on a meaningless, you know, end of game garbage time, essentially, wasn't it?
Feels like it's always the way, right?
Is there a way to donate your ACL? As a common man, how much do I use my ACL?
I don't know. You're working out in the, you know, in the gardens and doing physical stuff. Anyone's donating their ACL, it should be me.
Yeah, cough up, man. Give him, hand over an ACL.
I'm not sure if
the man needs one.
I think he has different dimensions, to be honest. Maybe Rich can donate his.
One of mine's already completely torn and has never been repaired, so I only have one good one, so I'm not dominating or giving up mine, sorry.
Okay, fair enough. We'll allow it. So, Bud's on IR. Dave's boy, Antoine Brooks Jr., has been raised up to the 53, so that's exciting for you, Dave, although you've lost one and gained another.
Yeah, when the man giveth and he taketh away, doesn't he? You know, you've got to take the positives.
Sadly, I think this is probably, I think, in my opinion, the last time we've seen Bud play for the Steelers. I don't know if you all agree. We spoke about this quite a bit in the season, but it's kind of a sudden way for it to go down.
It's not looking good, is it? It's I think everyone sort of saw Highsmith coming in the draft as being the potential replacement for Bud going forward. So it's not looking great, unless there's some sort of amazing deal that can be struck, which I don't think anyone can really see happening, but who knows, you know, stranger things happen at sea. It's up in the air, but the chances are, yeah, you're right, he's not going to be back in the Steelers camp again. He's going to be elsewhere, I think.
Do you think it makes Colbert's job a little bit easier in that the decision's kind of been made now?
I think so. Yeah, it's probably made it a bit easier for him. He's probably not outwardly sighed a bit of relief. I think maybe inwardly, not sort of expressing that, but yeah, I think it's made his job a little bit easier now. I think he's sort of got his sights on Juju a bit more now, and a few of the other guys, keeping those guys around.
I mean, the other way of looking at it is, if there is a savage drop in production from Highsmith, Ola, or whoever else, you know, that we hope steps up, that we see that will show us Dupree's worth. Right.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah.
We do need to pay this guy to keep up this identity that we've got.
I mean, I'm kind of predicting there will be a bit of a drop off. I think you can't just replace someone of Bud's, not just draft caliber, his ability. You know, his ability in in pass rush and particularly against the run, yeah, you can't really just replace that straight away with a rookie. I think you'd be fooling yourself if you think you're going to get that sort of productivity. I think there's going to be a drop off, and I think it's going to surprise people how much we do have a drop off in defensive wise. I think, you know, that whole defense sort of revolves around that line, particularly around TJ, and I think and in the last season around Bud as well. That whole ability to get to the quarterback. So yeah, I think there will be a big drop off. You guys probably disagree with me, but
yeah, I think it's going to be very interesting to see. I think this is what we've kind of. The silver line is this is kind of what we've wanted to know, you know. Obviously, we didn't want this to happen, but we've wanted to know for a long time, is Bud the beneficiary of TJ on the other side? You know, is this for real? How much of this is Bud and how much of this is, you know, scheme and whatnot? So it's going to be interesting to see that, you know, if nothing else. And when you talk about the drop-off, I should mention, for clarity's sake, I am now in the bag for the Highsmith family. So
right.
You know,
I was going to mention that later in the show. Do you want to mention
that? Yeah, yeah. I mean, I imagine that if anything, the production's going to go up now because we spoke to Sam Highsmith, Alex Highsmith's dad. He's a lovely gentleman. We spoke to him on the Shank Club last week before the game. Dave didn't join me, unbelievably, so he's now cast aside from the Highsmith family. He's not invited to the Thanksgiving dinner next year.
I was too busy, unfortunately, running errands, one of which was buying a new toilet. So I must be excused for that.
The Highsmiths trumped by Dave's toilet.
Well, it had an awful leak, and I would have been in big trouble if I hadn't gone and bought it. So yeah, that's my excuse. I'm standing by it.
Well, go if you get the chance, go check out the Shank Club's recording. It'll be on Twitter, I'm sure. You go check it out on the Shank Club NFL on Twitter. It's the first like 20 minutes, so you don't need to listen to the whole. It's a long show. It's like a 3-hour show, but you know, the first 20 minutes or so are us talking to Alex Highsmith's dad, so go find that if you can. It's an interesting chat. And to be fair, Gav, I don't know. What's that?
Go on. Sorry.
To be fair to you, I was going to say, when I was talking to Sam Highsmith, I did say, you know, I claimed Chase Claypool in the draft. That was my guy that I was, you know, proud we picked because that was who I pegged early. And I did point out that you were the guy that was all over Highsmith.
Oh, yes.
So he's aware of that.
Oh, great. That's good to know. Are you shifting over into the Highsmith camp now? You're rubbing shoulders with family?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
On the Christmas card list?
Yeah, we'll see. Maybe one more. Maybe get him on this show eventually, you know, and we'll see where we go from there.
Any teasers from the chat you want to drop?
It was just a good chat. Especially for anyone who's interested in stuff like the kind of the more family orientated side of the game. You know, we talk about the NFL draft and people like us who enjoy the kind of the more intimate moments, you know, the phone call at the draft and the draft day experience and what it's like raising a kind of an athletic dude that you think might have a chance to go to the NFL. We spoke about stuff like that, and for anyone that's interested in that kind of stuff, I think that's where you'll get the most value out of it.
And you should read James Conner's book as well, because that chapter about being drafted was the highlight for me. They got the old hairs going on the back of the neck. When you hear the phone conversation he had with Tomlin, that was a cool section in that book.
Oh, awesome. So I suppose what that leads us to now is, like I say, Alex Highsmith is now going to start in replacement of Bud Dupree. I've seen Sam tweeting out about it, getting the opportunity when you least expect it. You know, how worried are you, Gav and Rich, who we've not heard from yet, about this kind of change? Do you think there'll be a drop-off? Where do you think we'll be?
Okay, I'll take it. I think there's going to be a drop-off, for sure. I mean, Dupree's playing at a Pro Bowl level this year, and I think especially against the run, you know, sealing that edge on the outside, that's where we'll see it. But I initially was really bummed because we've talked about this a number of times. You got to stay healthy to get to the big game. You have to, and we've lost three starters. You know, so but the one thing that makes me feel fairly confident about the whole thing is, you know, this guy was drafted. He's a rookie. He's just drafted last year. He's coming into this season. I'm sure everybody just assumed, okay, Ola's going to be the first guy off the bench to replace either outside linebacker. But that was never the case. From game one, it was not even a question. Highsmith was the first guy coming off the bench to replace one of those two. So it tells me that the coaches really see something in this guy. And the limited time that he has played pretty well. So yes, it will be a drop off, but I don't think it's time to, you know, abandon ship by any means. I think we're going to probably be okay. You know, of course you want everybody healthy, but I think we're going to be okay. This isn't TJ that went down. This isn't Ben that went down. You know, Ben goes down, done, season over, mm-hmm. right? So I still think we're okay.
Yeah, building on your point, you're talking about, you know, the draft expectation. I mean, the kind of two major knocks. I mean, the big one was the small school, right? I think he's transcended that. He's shown he can produce on a big level. And the second one was the kind of position transition from, you know, he was kind of playing 3-point stance, defensive end, or rush end, and you know, would he translate to being, you know, a stand up linebacker in the kind of, you know, outside 3-4 system? I think he's proved that he can. So, you know, with this is the 13th game. You know, you said before he's a, you know, rookie, Dave. He's not a complete rookie. You know, this is the part of the season where you want your rookies to start coming through, and he's going to get the opportunity. So I'm excited for him, and I think he plays with, you know, want to, a physicality, aggression, and some good technique we've seen as well. So I reckon he can fill in. And I'm, you know, to try and put every silver lining as a cloud or whatever, you know, but... You know, obviously, it's a massive loss to lose Dupree at this, you know, on a great season he's having. But this is an opportunity for Highsmith, and I think it is exciting, and I think it could lead, you know, this could be another great partnership, you know, emerge out of, you know, the ashes of this last one. We could see Watt and Highsmith being a dynamic duo.
Mm, yeah, I certainly hope so. There's been talk that TJ might start to see major double teams and issues. Any concern around that?
Yeah, but then you've got, you know, you've got the rest of the beasts on that line. You've got Cam and Chewett and, you know, whoever else, Alu, you know, you can't just concentrate on one guy in the Steelers front.
Yeah,
you got, you know, then you leave yourself open to Williams or Hilton, you know, crashing down. So
yeah, I'm not too worried about it. The middle.
Yeah.
Do we put any credence in the whole James Harrison rumor that's circulating over the internet?
Well, I think James Harrison started this himself, right? I think he saw his opportunity to troll Steelers fans and decided to take a quick visit to the Steelers doctor, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Rich, I imagine you've seen this, right? What do you think?
Yeah, I saw that. And, you know, I follow him on Instagram, and, man, he still looks like he could play.
Oh, yeah, right? Have you seen those commercials tackling that poor dude?
Yeah, that guy mistakenly stops to catch his breath, yeah. Hey, it's not going to happen, but it's kind of fun to think about, because I thought the guy still had something left in the tank when he retired, to be honest with you. Mm. You know, I mean, I could see him doing something like Highsmith was doing, coming off and spelling guys for a while, because he's, you know, he still has a few good rushes left in him. And if you remember that guy's career, I've never seen anybody held so much and it not called. Because he was shorter and he had so much leverage and he got so low, these guys would wrap their arms around his neck almost every play to hold him back, and they very rarely called it. The guys, I think, as great as he was still underrated.
So I've missed this tweet because I've been, you know, stood in a muddy field in the middle of nowhere getting rained on. Let's not go there. But does this mean that Harrison has buried the peace pipe or is sat on an olive branch or whatever the expression is? Is he forgiven the Steelers?
I don't know. It was done in a typical Harrison style, so it's hard to tell. But I think it's more the other direction. I think some Steelers fans are very split, right, on whether they want to welcome Harrison back with open arms.
Yeah.
I don't think I ever hated him. No. I mean, I was disappointed.
Yeah, yeah.
I wasn't angry. I was disappointed in him, but in my best dad words. But no, I didn't hate him for it. It was a business decision. He's making money at the end of the day. It's a job. Exactly. You know, he's got to go where he's going to get the money.
Yeah. I never understood that. I never. That's just ignorance at its height, right there. The guy. It's just his job. You know. He didn't ask to leave the Steelers. You know. It was. You know, what are you going to do? That's the team that's offering you a job. This is how you put food on the table for your children. Like, people need to just get a clue. You know, that's his job. Like, what do you expect? It was I never understood that.
I think he did enjoy the a bit of the vibe though, Rich. Like, I think he enjoyed trolling a little bit when he was on the
pitches. Wasn't it more that he was pissed off with the Steelers because he He wasn't getting played. He felt he was maltreated. So when I said about the peace offering, I thought it was more from Harrison. Is he prepared to forgive and forget rather than the fans? I don't think especially the Steelers. There's an angry, seething mob with everything. So let's just forget that. Don't worry about them. It's more about Harrison. Has he moved on? Is he, you know? I imagine those eyes, and then just think, as he, you know, is he that scary eyes just staring out of the darkness at you? You know, is he still holding that rage? I don't know.
I doubt it. I don't think so. You know, I don't get that impression from. Like I said, I follow the guy, and you know, I never really got that impression from him. I think he was more ticked off at Tomlin than anything else, because I think, you know, Tomlin had told him some things. How they were going to use him, and they just didn't do it. And I believe the guy. I don't think the guy's a liar. I've listened to a lot of what he said, and he doesn't come across as a liar to me. And I don't think Tomlin necessarily was lying. I think Tomlin probably changed his mind. You know, he's the coach. Things pop up, and you know, you decide to change strategies, and that's just how it is. But that doesn't mean that, you know, you tell somebody you're going to do something, doesn't mean they shouldn't be upset either. It's just a bad situation. But I'm sure if given the opportunity, he would absolutely come back. But like I said, I doubt that'll happen.
Yeah, well, I think we spent far too long talking about it, considering the likelihood of it happening. But it was an interesting bit piece this week anyway. Right, should we get into the game?
Yeah.
Let's do it. Since we're nearly 20 minutes in. It's rare that we get this far in without talking about it. So the Ravens game, obviously we end up playing on Wednesday after a very topsy-turvy week, 6 days after when the game was originally scheduled, hence why this episode is coming to you so late in the week. This game kicks off, and the start of this game was legitimately wild, right? I had you know, friends of mine that watch the NFL messaging me that, you know, that aren't Steelers fans, going, dude, what is going on here? Like, this game is crazy. You know, I won't go through the whole game, obviously, but let me just kind of lay out some of the things that happened early in this game. You know, it begins with a three and out from both teams. The Ravens then fumble a snap on their first play back on the field. Ben throws a floater straight to Tyus Bowser on fourth down in the end zone. Rather than kneel, though, he brings it out to the 25 by getting tackled. Rather than kneel and bring it out to the 25, he gets tackled at the 6, inexplicably, which was an awful decision on his part. Then 3 plays later, RG3 throws a pick 6 to Joe Hayden. Boz misses the extra point. They go three and out again and punt, but then Ray musts the fair catch and the Ravens score a touchdown 4 plays later. You know, by the end of the first quarter, pretty much, that was the point we were at, and you just knew it was going to be one of those games, you know? They were winning 7-6, and you were like, how is this happening? And you could immediately tell this was not going to be one of those enjoyable afternoons for the Steelers.
Yeah, although one of my favourite, like, what was it, like screwball, scramble, gumball moment was the botched Ravens read option mesh point play where Edwards and RG3 both ran away from the ball and just left the ball hanging in the air.
Yeah.
And it just kind of dropped like a Fabergé egg onto the floor. That was good. Do you think this was slightly, I don't know if it was everyone, but Steelers Twitter seemed to be brimming with massive overconfidence pre-game. 100%. And then we had Tuitt's tweet about, you know, just padding stats and everything.
Awful.
Do you think that mentality had crept in, maybe? Or do you think some of the disruption with this game kept moving around 3 different times? Was it going to be played? Was it not? Who's playing? Do you think that had kind of had an effect on the preparation for this game that kind of led to that beginning and just the general overall feel of this game?
I'm sure it did. I tend to sometimes put maybe less emphasis on that kind of disruption stuff than maybe I should. I know a lot of people put a lot of weight into that stuff. So, you know, maybe this, you know, I've seen a lot of people in the national media this week say, you know, with a lot of eyes on this game, obviously, because it was played on its own on a Wednesday, say, listen, this is a game that you throw out if any game ever gets thrown out. You know, this is a team where both teams were missing major pieces. Obviously, the Ravens more so, but you know, this is a game where you've got players totally unaware of when they're going to play up until 24 hours before the game, and it could have moved again, and nobody knew it was happening, and training was all off the pace, and I'm sure that affects everyone, right? Mentally, especially, that's got to be the hardest part, right? Getting hyped up to play a professional game of football. I mean, I can't even imagine. So, yeah, I'm sure that had an impact, but I don't think you can throw away some of the concerns we saw in this game, which we'll get to.
No. And I think on that same note, I think you have to give credit to the Ravens, actually.
Yep.
To show up and to make a game of it with, you know, with what they had. They made a decent game plan, you know, with Lamar G3, didn't they? Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
You knew it'd be close. It always is, right? No matter what the circumstances.
Yeah, and you know they seem to have a effective way of like they were talking on the broadcast, weren't they, about stopping the Steelers run run D and stuff, and you know they were killing the Steelers quick pass offense at points, although that came back as well. But you know, but then their secondary just imploded, and you know that was kind of the end of the game, really, wasn't it?
Yeah, you know, a credit. It's hard to give credit to him because I think more than any season ever before, he's proven himself to be frankly a little bitch. But Harbaugh is. You know, legitimately a good coach, right? And he finds ways to frustrate the Steelers. I'm sorry if that offended anyone, but he is just, you know, he's obsessively annoying, you know, frankly. I mean, the bitch fit he threw on the sideline, I mean, it was complete shithousery at the end of the first half, right? I know I'm jumping all over the place, but...
To be fair, if you flip that the other way around, we'd be screaming blue murder. The air would be blue.
I imagine you screaming blue murder, so I've seen you do it.
Yeah, you know, I probably would have been, but I'm not the head coach of the Baltimore Ravens, you know?
Yeah. It did seem a little bit time-wasty.
Oh, it was. I'm not saying it wasn't. I'm saying it absolutely was. But also, you know, use your timeouts better, you know? I don't know.
Sure.
Yeah.
Anyway, he particularly annoyed me in this game. But to be honest, what do you think about... Let's talk about that play very quickly. Is that... I want to ask Rich. Rich, is that bad sportsmanship? Or are you on board with that?
I'm sorry.
Yeah, this is the play where, you know, the guys are lying down at the end of the half and it ends up in the Ravens not getting any points.
Yeah, you know, I think it's a little bit of both. I don't think there's any team in the NFL that's above it, put it that way. And Harbaugh certainly isn't above it. Mm-hmm. I know he's ticked off about it. But, yeah, I mean, it's a little bit. But, I mean, like I said, stuff like that happens in the NFL, and even worse. You know, these guys play to win. And if they're going to stretch it as far as they can, you know, they're going to stretch that rule as far as they possibly can and hope they don't break it and give themselves the biggest advantage possible. And that goes for the coaches as well. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we see stuff like that every week, right? There was very little downside to doing it because they're already on the goal line with a few seconds left. So the worst they get is a penalty, right? So you got to be looking at the refs. I don't know. It was what it was. Anyway, let's move on.
Every team's doing that. Yeah, kind of stuff, exactly. Trying to get a competitive advantage. Look at what the things that Belichick's done over the years creative rule book reading. So let's calm down on the cheating.
I'm kind of trying to check myself. Like, am I being overly biased? I don't know. I might be. But I thought it was kind of funny. I did point out that it was, you know, classic shithousery. So I think that's fair. okay, let's jump into some of the players. Let's start, as we often do, with the offense and Ben in this game. I think it's easier to talk about Ben and the receivers together this week because, you know, I felt he was let down a fair bit with a ton of questionable play and drops, which I'm sure we'll get to. He actually threw over 50 times this week, which I think says something about our run game as well, but we'll get to that. Ben, though, specifically, I mean, some questionable decision-making, right? You know, especially on the goal line, we were, I think, 1-4 in the red zone, which has been rare this season. He misses a wide-open Derek Watt early in the game, right? Just doesn't... Mm. I mean, he's looking right at him, doesn't seem to consider him as an option. Maybe he wasn't even really there.
I don't know. I watched that again, and it's very noisy in front of him. There's, you know, Watt's not the biggest dude. There's a lot of big dudes all mauling each other right in front of him. And maybe he just did, you know, in that... You know, you've got and one and two, and the ball's got to go. He didn't see it. Yeah. So you can rag him on that, and maybe, you know, someone else would have seen it. But, you know, that was a tough situation. And I mean, the real decision, well, should he have thrown it at all or should he have just thrown it away?
Exactly.
I mean, that's the real criticism. You know, he sort of went into classic backyard Ben, didn't he? Just, I'm going to, you know, lob this up for a jump ball and see what happens. But it wasn't a jump ball at all. It was just straight to him. So a disappointing play, that one.
My question was, why did they have the personnel out there that they did? You know, that was an empty backfield, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because he was like...
So they had... The only receiver they had out there was Claypool. They had McDonald. They had... Or wide receiver. They had Claypool, McDonald, Ebron, Watt, and Snell. Now, why do they have those people out there for an empty backfield? I don't get personnel. I don't understand. The last time I saw that, they ran a screen out of it because they have all that beef out there to block for the receiver catching the screen. But it didn't look like they set up for a screen at all. It was really weird.
Is it some chicanery to try and get the Ravens to go big and then get Claypool 101 on some kind of trick?
I think you're outsmarting yourself, though. You know, you want your gazelles out there. You know, like I don't understand the thinking behind it. Maybe if I don't know, I thought maybe you guys might have an idea.
That was my idea, but yeah, didn't seem like you liked it very much.
I usually like your ideas, Gav. I mean,
even Gav can't cover up for Randy Fitchner today. But you know, he ends up with 266 yards and a kind of a stat line you expect with 36 for 51, one touchdown, one interception. But a lot of this is drops on the receivers, right? I mean, we'll talk about that at the same time. What was going on with the receivers today? I mean, I've seen differing reports. Steelers Depot kind of did the hard work for me and counted 6 drops. I think it might be even more, depending on what you want to classify as a drop. When I went through, it looked more like kind of 8 or 9 to me. But yeah, Whatever you want to classify it as.
It was frustrating because they made so many tough catches.
Yep.
We had like spinning catches. We had DJ making catches that were outside of his sort of zone, like his catch radius. Kind of some awesome catches, but then just drops that should have been caught.
And it's like, mental problems. Yeah.
I wondered if it was the cold or, you know, someone should get DJ a jugs machine. Just get that in his garage or whatever.
I think DJ needs a psychologist, somebody to a sports psychologist, somebody to get him to concentrate better. Because he's got the hands. Remember that? Do you guys remember that catch he made where he turned around at the last second and the ball was right in front of his face? Like that takes hands and concentration. So he has it, but it's not. Every time he dropped a pass, and I counted 3 for DJ, I heard Dave in my ear, you know, because this is like he's not concentrating. He's like, and you know, Dave's been saying that all season that he just, there's something up with this kid's concentration. I don't know what to think of him. I really don't. Like, it's really odd. Then one of those would have been a touchdown. Ben, it was a third down play. I don't know if you guys remember, and Ben dropped it right into his hands. Mm-hmm. I mean, the pass was perfect, and he just dropped it, you know. And Claypool dropped a touchdown. Ebron dropped a possible touchdown. I mean, these were big plays, and I counted 8 too. By the way, Simon, yeah. I counted 8 drops. You know, I mean, if these guys just catch these passes, I don't think this game is even close.
You know, on DJ, I mean, all I can really apply concentration to is things that I've done. So I can only apply it sport-wise to archery. So if I think DJ is an instinctual catcher of the ball. It's instinct. He's not, as soon as he concentrates, it's gone. I think, because when you're shooting, if you switch off your brain and you just go on instinct, you're fine. As soon as you start thinking about little things you're doing, little movements, then you start messing up. I think like that one catch where it was way outside of his body and it was behind him and he caught it. That was a great catch. And that was purely instinct. That went off a snap reaction. That took, I think Collinsworth even said that probably, he probably saw that ball for a fraction of a second. And that was an instinctual catch. And that is where he's at his best. As soon as he has time to think, that's when he starts messing up.
I like it. So you're saying he needs to be more zen. So he needs to get like into the mountains, ring some bells, light some incense.
Not that even kind of thing. Not even that. Just stop thinking. Stop thinking, I've caught the ball and I'm 5 yards down the field. You wait till the ball's in your hands. Just let the process happen. He's too busy thinking ahead of who he's going to juke next.
It's a very similar problem to what McFarlane's suffering from, I think.
Yeah, maybe.
But don't on a think feel. Different scale, yeah. It's when he has time. Yeah, you're totally right, Dave. It's when he has time to think. It's always the easier passes, you know, when they're right on the money, or he's seeing them come towards him for a second and a half, you know.
Yeah.
So, but he wasn't the only one this week, right? I mean, Ebron had a couple of stinkers. Even though Ebron led the team in receiving, I think he did have a couple of stinkers. And they were the easy passes.
I forgive Ebron, man. Ebron, the way Ebron gets separation, I'll forgive a few drops because he just gets open, and I love it. I can't think of a Steelers tight end that's ever got separation like him. Rich, can you?
Maybe Eric Green.
You think?
Yeah, Eric Green was a real good tight end, real good pass receiving tight end. Maybe I'd have to. I mean, he's played a way back, but I'd have to see some film. But Eric Green was a really good pass receiving tight end.
Why do we keep getting Ebron blocking? Because the dude stinks of blocking. I think any of us could probably run, give him a good run for his money on blocking.
I don't know. There's been moments where he's been good, man.
I think the problem is the scheme, though, right? We keep running, you know, stunts to his side and then, like, you know, running kind of weird plays where he's required to put in a key block. I mean, maybe Rich can speak better to this than I do, but I feel like he's always, like, a key blocker on certain run plays. And I'm like, why is this dude being relied on so much?
Yeah. Don't know.
Well, it's nice to see Vance back in there, wasn't it? And that screenplay in particular was nice. Physicality.
Yeah, it was.
Just to go back to Ben, though, I thought his accuracy was up another tick.
It was, yeah.
The deep shots all on target. The beaut to the DJ at the end, which was broken up, that was lovely. And then, yeah, I think he's getting into peak, you know, late season form. Just hope the rest of the receiving core peaks at the same time as we get moved towards playoffs.
Yeah, this isn't something we've seen a lot of, so I'm hoping it's a one-week apparition.
You know, and props to Ben, who learned something from the Antonio Brown situation. If you guys watched the interview with him right after the game, he took it all on his shoulders, and he really, that's really undeserved because he played a great game. I would say 90% of those passes that were dropped were really good passes that were normally easy catches for these guys, and he took it all on his shoulders and didn't throw one guy under the bus. And he praised James Washington, who definitely deserved it, because that pass James caught at the end of the towards the end of the game was, man, as soon as I let go of that pass, I'm like, oh no, because it just hung in the air for like years. I was like, oh my god.
I mean, to me, people are going to say I'm stupid for saying this, but for me, that was a better catch than the DeAndre Hopkins triple hands catch in the end zone.
Come on, Gav.
Yeah.
I thought that Washington catch was more impressive. The other one.
No, it wasn't. You know, Gav, come on.
Okay. Well, that's what I'm saying. I knew it would create controversy. I knew he high pointed the ball amazingly well. But that pass to Washington was getting intercepted, and somehow Washington made it. It just got his lobster hat, got his lobster claws up, and just reeled that in.
That is pure farmer strength. That is. That's hands like shovels, farmer strength. That is. That was pure, that was a pure strength and determination to get that ball in his hands.
I said this last week, right? But James Washington needs to get more looks, right? Especially in a game like this where, you've got guys all over the field who can't catch, apparently, all of a sudden. You know, they've all got the yips. This dude's kind of reliable. I don't know who you scheme out and who leaves the field, but, I mean, first of all, that play, it's a ballsy play. It might even be the wrong play. It might even be stupid. To be honest, I mean, how many times have we seen the Steelers do something like that and put themselves in a really precarious position for no reason? I don't know if that's more on Ben or if that was the plan or I don't know, but it was probably a stupid thing to do. Frankly,
do you think Ben as he let that ball go, he just thought, oh shit, and then Washington was he appeared with the ball, so surely that's going to grow confidence. He's like, I can trust this guy.
Yeah,
you know,
I hope so. He deserves it, dude. Yeah, but I mean, Claypool worried me this week, right? I mean, he's so fantastic. We spoke all about it, but I think you've got to point out that there's been some similar. No, I don't think the concentration issues like DJ's, but just brick hand looking stuff all of a sudden.
I'm not worried about Claypool. I think we have to give him the little credit for not for jumping up when he wasn't down, because that could have been easy, been a rookie mistake there, right? To think he was down with no contact.
Like, oh yeah, that was great. Yeah.
So to just to jump up and get more yards. So, Claypool's it's rookie season, man. Give him a break.
I know. Listen, I'm not getting on the guy, but my job here, if I have one, is to point out what I see on the field, right? And if we're going to gush about a guy 1 week, I got to point out that, it's not all, sunshine and roses coming out of his backside. It's particularly egregious. I think the one in the end zone, I think, Rich, you mentioned it earlier. That was one of the hardest ones for me to classify as a drop or not, because there was some decent pass defense there. You know, a guy got his arm in. He probably should have caught it, but I can see why you wouldn't count that as a drop. But the one where he lets it go straight into his chest, I mean, that's just, I don't know what that is. And we've seen that a few times. So, again, I don't want to get on him too much, but you combine that with what everyone else is doing, and it becomes a bit of an epidemic.
Well, Claypool has consistently dropped a pass every game. Mm-hmm. You know, he's starting to remind me of Terrell Owens. So I guess you can make it to the Hall of Fame and not have great hands, but it's a tougher road, but they have similar physicality, both big, strong, fast guys. you know. But man, yeah, it's just, you just know eventually it's going to happen. It's odds, right? It's going to happen where it's going to be a big catch in the end zone to win the game, and he's going to drop it. And
that's the fear.
I guess that setting is going to slide somewhere between T.O. at one end and Lima Swede at the other. Where does that dial rest? Is Claypool's destiny, isn't it?
Right.
Let's hope it's towards the T.O. end or beyond it.
Do these GMs? I honestly think sometimes I've got a tangent here, but these GMs ever consider just drafting by name? Because I think sometimes if you just draft by what a guy sounds like, you might do better than with all the scouting, and you save a lot as well.
Whoever drafted Lamar Jackson and AJ Green this year, it's not working out so well.
Well, I suppose that's true, yeah. But I mean, if you're drafting a guy called what was it?
Which one?
The Swede.
Limus Swede.
Linus Swede. Yeah.
Limus with a M.
Limus Swede. I mean, you're asking for it, really, aren't you? Who's seeing Limus Swede in the Hall of Fame?
Hey, we got him in the second round, and it was a steal. And we looked at this. Really, he was a great receiver with Texas. He was really, really good. This was one of those things that just, who knows why it happens. Okay. You know, the guy.
Flash forward, it wasn't a steal.
I apologize, Rich. I don't know a lot about it, but I don't know. I just think sometimes draft on name. Yeah.
From steal to bust. The Lima Swede story.
Good point. It's probably the last Limus we ever draft. So.
I'm sure there'll be another coming up soon. I wanted to ask you quickly before we move on from the receivers and Ben. I want to ask Gav specifically. This week especially, it's kind of come out more and more. People are talking a lot about this Big Breeze comparison. If you listen to Around the NFL and Greg Rosenthal, Mina Kimes has chipped in now. What's your thoughts on that?
Well, it's definitely, I don't know about that fully, but it's definitely, they're now wearing teams down with the pass. Like, you know, teams traditionally used to wear teams down with a run, right? And now the Steelers just pass you to death. I don't know about the comparison. Was it also built on the fact that Ben's deep ball seemed to be going and Breeze is obviously long gone? I think Ben proved that his deep ball's coming back, and it was just a road back from recovery from the elbow surgery. So I'm not sure. I understand it's a total, like shift in philosophy with handling Ben from where he was before. But I think this is a different thing to Breeze. I don't think so. What do you think?
Yeah, I tend to agree. I kind of get what they're going for, that he's kind of a game manager in a good way, you know, like a supreme game manager like Breeze. It's kind of a compliment like 2017 Breeze, but... it's all based on this quick passing game, right? And it is kind of true, right? In this game, I think every receiver averaged under 10 yards a catch. So, apart from the running backs, ironically. But, you know, that's the game that we're going for here, and he's getting the ball out so quick, you can kind of see where the comparison comes from. But, yeah, I agree with you. The deep ball's there, it's just maybe not coming off when the national guys are watching.
Yeah, and the mid-range stuff, it's the power ball's there as well. We saw that a few, you know, later, in, you know, where it's almost a deep ball. Those were looking good too. So let's just lay off with the game manager tag for a while.
Oh,
he's
I
just,
agree.
He's just spreading it around.
Yeah. Speaking of the running backs, this might be a good one for Dave to take over.
Are we going to glaze over Juju Stiffarm?
Oh, sorry. Go on.
Juju Stiffarm.
There you go. Right. Let's speaking of the running backs.
That was an impressive sister. That's one for the highlight reel for Juju. That is.
Yeah.
That was. I love that. I'm still watching that on repeat. That's great. Love it.
Better stiff arm in this game, Dave. Juju's or Benny Snell's? Which is kind of just power stiff arm, power rush. I don't know what you call that. It was almost like a stiff arm, wasn't it? It was just like I'm rushing at you with an arm out.
Yeah, that wasn't really a true stiff arm or anything. I think Juju's was a true sort of you're going down, you're getting out of my way. That was I love that one. But I thought Snell in this game was, I won't say it's his best game that he's had in Buffalo, but it was his most, what's the word, mature. It's his most accomplished game he's had. He's had better, particularly stat-wise, he's had better games. But
were you on your feet for the long one, the good, you know, the one where he bounced it in the fourth quarter?
Yeah, I thought he was going to go all the way to the house. I had visions of that green grass opening up in front of him and just going, but no, it didn't happen. But it was great. I thought he really showed that he'd learned you know, there was a bit of a concern on him of being a fumbler, and if you start fumbling, I mean, he had, what, two fumbles, two games, I think, earlier in the season.
Yeah.
And there was a concern about ball security, and as Collingsworth loved pointing out, the Ravens are good at ripping the ball out. He must mention that about 20 times. That you saw it every time he had the ball in his hands. It was great ball security, keeping it close to his chest, both hands on the ball. It was he'd learned from his mistakes, which is what you want to see. If someone keeps making the same mistake over and over again, there's a concern. If you learn from your mistakes, it's great. But with Snell, I felt more confident in him than I do with Connor. And whether that's a popular opinion or not, I don't know. But when you look at Connor in previous games, he's probably averaging, I haven't got stats in front of me, but he's probably averaging about 40 yards off 18 to 20 something carries. I can't remember exactly. But I mean, Snell's had 60 yards off 16 carries and then 33 yards off 3 receptions. He's shown himself to not just be a power back. That's what everyone thought Snell was. He's the guy who just charges headlong into the middle of the line, and you see he picks up a few yards. He's shown himself to have been more mature. He's obviously taken some coaching. He's learned to use his hands and run a few few routes and work out of the backfield. I'm seeing a lot of encouraging things out of Snell going forward. I think he can potentially become a long-staying Steeler, whether he's a feature back or whatever, I don't know. But I think he's going to stay as a Steeler for quite a while. I'm encouraged by this. Are you guys on board with me, or am I on my own on an island with this?
Well, do you guys remember a few games ago I said for this particular game, analyzing the running game, I said that Snell would have been a better choice?
Yes.
You know, after this game, I really think because of the way our line is run blocking or lack of run blocking, I think Snell is the better guy going forward. Now, I still think Connor is a better back. I think he has more tools in the toolbox. But because of just how things are shaping up with our line, the type of style that Snell has, I think, is more conducive to the type of blocking our line is doing.
Do you feel like Snell has somewhat better vision? Like he sees as it sort of develops and hits it. Well, he's obviously, as a power back, he's sort of hitting the hole faster and harder. Is his vision... What am I trying to say here? Is he
more
vision,
explosive? Are you saying?
Yeah. Basically, is he seeing things develop before they happen? Whereas Connor's more sort of in the sort of maybe in the Lev Bell mold of waiting for things to happen.
Yeah, I think there's something to that, and I think that Connor has adapted to what's going on with, or I'm not, I'm sorry. I think Benny has adapted to what's going on with our run blocking better than Connor has. I think it makes you can't necessarily always expect the hole to be there. And the adjustments that Benny has made to those particular situations have been quicker and better than James Connor, I think.
I mean, for what it's worth, I just did this.
Go on.
So I was going to say, for what it's worth, I just did the quick sums, and Connor's on 4.45 yards per average this season, and Snell's on 3.49. But you could say that's usage because Snell's short yardage.
Well, Connor had a big game the week before. I wonder what the stats would have been the week before. I bet they wouldn't have been that good. He had a really good game, and the line actually blocked better that game.
And also, Connor, often we've talked about before, he often breaks like one long run and then has a load of 1 and 2 yarders.
For sure. And I think he is. Like I said, I think he's the better back all around. I think if you have a strong offensive line that's opening up holes for your backs to run through, I would rather have Connor running them. I think he's more creative. But
I'm with you. It's funny you said that. Do you know, I was actually literally about to... I was waiting for you to finish speaking. I was going to say, I'm totally with Rich. I think he's a more creative bat, but maybe that's not what we need right now. So, yeah, I'm totally on board with you. I think that's a really good point. Maybe Benny isn't the better back, but he's just... fits what we've got now. He's more of a no-nonsense guy. I don't think he has better vision, you know, as such. I think it's just a usage case. I just think Connor's going to struggle when he's not got any space and he's got guys in his face already in the backfield, whereas Benny's going to grind out those hard yards, right? So yeah. It depends what you want. And maybe that's a game-by-game basis. I was happy to see him, you know, like you say as well, Dave, grab some balls out of the air as well and look a bit more well-rounded and do things that people maybe didn't expect out of him. And that kind of usage was nice to see as well.
I just feel like anyone that thinks that Benny Snell's a purely a short yardage power back is sleeping on him a bit too much. He's more than that.
Yeah.
He's proved himself to be more than that in this game.
I gotta be honest, I was a bit disappointed with McFarland. I mean, he only had 3 attempts, but I've kind of been a bit disappointed by the fact that he hasn't forced more usage. And in this game, in the attempts that he did have, it just, to me, do you know what it feels like? I've said this a couple of times now, I think. It just feels like he leaves yards on the field. He has like an erratic running style. You know, he feels like he's going to pop off, but he's yet to do it.
I thought this was his best game in, I mean, it's still in very limited bursts, yeah. But he showed that nice cut, didn't he, on that one play, just what, yeah. Like a violent, exciting cut.
Well, I think he has it, that's what I mean, but then at the same time, yeah. He's in open space
but this, so far this season, all he's done is kind of fall over or get tackled. So the fact that he did that cut and kind of caught a few people out of surprise, promise, and then he did show the sweet hands on the reception. Yeah. So
the reception was good.
It's something to build on. I think it's, you know, you can we go forward. Hopefully
with Connor out though, and him being the second back in this rotation for this game, I was kind of hoping we might see a bit more out of him. You know.
Yeah, but it seems like slowly, and this was a tough division game that was, you know, going. If maybe we would have seen more of him if this game had gone out like Tuitt had predicted, you know, it didn't go that way. So it was a tight game up until the end. So they, you know, let's not risk it.
Any thoughts on McFarland, Rich, as the resident running man?
Well, I like the way they finally are using him properly. I think they're not, you know, they're not putting him in on 3rd and 1, expecting him to get a first down. They're putting him out in space. That's what you need to do with a back like that. You know, he was lined up wide a few times in the passing game, which I think is great. And he had a big, he tore off a big one, what, for 17 yards, I think,
on the catch.
Yeah. So, yeah, I like it. Get the guy in space. You know, that's what you need to do with that type of back. And, yeah, they were doing it. I like the way they used him a lot.
I would like to see more of him lined up outside, I agree. Yeah, there's just something about him getting it. I don't know if I'm expressing it correctly, but it's like a kind of a strange running style. It kind of puts me on edge. I don't know if anybody else feels this way, but like...
He runs a little bit like Terrell Edmonds. It's sort of... The legs are quite wide out, and it's sort of a... Yeah, it's an erratic sort of madman run with the arms flailing.
Yeah,
how it kind of it's almost like he's dangling a leg out there for someone to catch and pull him down with. It's not a tight, compact run. It's very flaily.
I mean, he hasn't even fumbled yet, right? But in my mind, my heart's in my throat for some reason. Like I'm just watching the ball constantly. Like I feel like it's flying all over the place. But time will tell. I think maybe I'm being a bit unfair on that, but. We'll see where that goes. Disappointing I didn't see any Smallwood. He was called up from the practice squad, but like you say, that's more game script, I think. Maybe we would have seen a little bit if the game had got out of hand, but it didn't. So, alas, no Wendell Smallwood for us. The O-line, I don't know what to say about this, really. I mean, Hassanau is the main guy I want to mention. He stepped up with Pouncey going out on the COVID list. Stepped in reasonably well at centre. There was, I think, 1 or 2 snaps where I was like, ooh, but then Pouncey does that every game as well, so... what did you see from the O-line this game?
Yeah, I mean, I haven't had time to delve into the All-22, unfortunately, which is where I get all my light. Yeah, because standing in a field with no toilet is, you know, I'm not going to come back to it. Anyway, let's not go back there again.
Sounds like a weekend at M&T Bank Stadium.
if only there was a porta potty, I'd risk my life for a porta potty today. I did notice that the Ravens were doing the delayed blitzes really well.
Yes,
so that was absolutely confusing the Steelers O line. They did, and there was one play where Hassanau and Filer just let was it Tyus Bowser on a delayed blitz? He just got in between them, and they both. Hass and Filer just looked at each other like, "Who, me? Were you blocking him? Was I?" And it led to one of the nasty Ben hits. So that wasn't cool. But without going through the All-22, I'm just kind of a lot. I haven't got the kind of normal intel that I have on how I thought they'd play. But On the whole, I thought it was okay. I wasn't, again, the run game didn't seem to have a massive push, but as always, the pass protection seemed okay, apart from when they did the delayed blitzes, which they just seemed to have free runners coming at Ben.
I was a bit disappointed that the running game didn't see some improvement with Calais Campbell out and a slightly weaker line, but like you say, the Ravens managed to dial up some nice pressure. It should be pointed out that even with Ben dropping back 50 times in this game, he hasn't taken a single sack in this game or in the last four consecutive games. So, I mean, we spoke about it before, right? The run game's struggling, but the pass blocking remains at a high standard, even though he did get hit a little bit in this game. Rich, you see anything else? I know we've not had a lot of time to analyse it, but...
Yeah, no, I haven't. I don't even know if the All-22 is even out yet. I haven't seen it. But Hausenhauer had a horrible start. Let not one but two guys get to Ben on one play, and he was like monitoring the right side of the line. He had his hand on DeCastro, and he's monitoring the right. And he's not even looking left, and two guys run right by him. I was like, oh no. But he tightened up after that, and the O line was great on pass protection again, and running. From what I just can remember watching the game one time, it seemed like the O line was pretty much the way they've been playing all year. They have mostly not great, and then a few good plays here and there, running the ball. Yeah, that's about it.
Yeah,
I think I texted you guys when Okorfor went out and Filer kicked out to tackle and Dotson came in at left guard. I thought maybe this is the line we should be playing. No offense to Jux, because he's been playing well, but it just suddenly I felt more confident. But then it was only for one snap, and then they reverted back. So clearly I was wrong.
It's a weird decision, that, isn't it? Just the quirks of which positions these guys are comfortable in kind of leads us to leave Dotson out, even though I'd argue that he's maybe a great option there, but especially given our struggles.
Sorry. I did see him. We were on the goal line. I did see him. They brought him in because Hawkins is out. They brought him in for that extra lineman. And he missed the block completely. The guy made, you know.
Yeah.
But I still like the guy. I think he's got a lot of potential. He's a rookie, and I think he's going to eventually be one of our starters for sure.
Yeah, he seems more like a pass, another pass protector rather than a run blocker. So I think do I need to hit this in the draft? Just go and get a road grader, you know? I don't know.
Yeah.
Moving on to the defense. Kind of a strange game because we didn't give up a lot in the air until the very end. The run game was obviously the focus for the Ravens, especially coming from the quarterback, even though they had the two running backs out on the COVID list in this one. We started the D-line. Cam got a pretty baller sack. I think I messaged you guys during the game where he bulldozed RG3 and kind of pushed him over. I think if you watch the tape, he actually thought that RG3 had thrown the ball. He turns around. But
yeah,
the push was so... What I likened it to was it looked like one of those nightclub fights where like a big dude pushes like a mouthy little drunk guy and he just stumbles and knocks himself out before the fight even starts. Like, I like that. That really tickled me.
Yeah. Yeah, it was the swim move to get past the lineman was beautiful on that. Absolutely textbook.
And then, of course, Mondu. I think I'm going to start calling him Mondu.
It's Mondo, man.
I like that the commentators are going with Mondu. So yeah. I think that, and it's easy to spell.
Have they got that from somewhere? Is it like a French-Canadian thing that they know about? Because to me, that's Mondo, man. That's, you know, through and through.
Maybe we need to ask Mondo himself.
Don't trust the commentators. They couldn't work out who was Juju and who was DJ through most of the game, so don't trust them.
They do need to separate the numbers a bit.
Let's tweet him. Let's tweet him directly. Can we find out?
Has he got a Twitter? I'll look into that.
We want a phonetic explanation. Oh, because I've betting money on it. Oh, man.
I do agree with you, but I just prefer this. Like, phonetically, it's much easier for me to spell it in the mock-up that I do before the episode, so I like writing Mondu. So even if it is Mondo, I'm going to continue to spell it as Mondo. Him and Wormley filled in with two it out, registered a couple tackles apiece, which I'm sure Gav will gush over now.
That was a great swarm tackle.
Is that it, Gav? Nothing.
That's it. Yeah.
No awards for Mondu, player of the week.
No, not yet. I still like it. I think he's a good player. I think he's got a role as a kind of, you know,
spelling. You know, this is what I was saying. You know, he's a good interior defensive lineman. I think, you know, he's not going to be a starter, but he's got the strength, got the push, comes in, you know, does some damage, goes off again. That's his role. I like him for it.
Fair enough. Yeah, I mean, when we talk, I agree with you. We're talking about in the draft, we're looking for that sixth, seventh round D tackle, weren't we? You know, and that's what's going on here. So can't complain. We didn't have to spend any draft capital on it. We did allow RG3 to rush for 68 yards, which is like double what he threw for. On
there seven times where I thought this was like 2012 again, because it just had the read option. Come on, man. We know the playbook for that, don't we? We know how to deal with that. I mean, what was it, something else? Or was it... That's what it seemed like to me. It was read option and it was play action.
Yeah.
That was what they were having success on.
Given our secondary, the quality of our secondary compared to the receivers they had available, mixed in with the fact that we know that they're going to run it and they've got a guy who is, you know, let's be honest, not Lamar Jackson. He's mobile, but he's not Lamar Jackson level. It was disappointing to me that we let him catch us on the outside so much, but, you know, that is what it is.
But then, obviously, Joe Hayden's been studying on him on tape, because that the way he broke on that pass was absolutely beautiful. But did you notice that he did the exact same break on that play for the Trace McSorley touchdown? Almost identical. So he obviously, you know, that goes to show you, that's what, you know, not having tape versus not having tape.
Are you saying it was partly his fault?
Yeah, it was Hayden's fault, I think.
I mean,
I know you're gonna, you know.
I'll be honest. I'm gonna absolutely murder Edmonds in a second. So
you're gonna say, you know, negative aspect of Edmonds. But you know, if one of my favourite films, Any Given Sunday, you haven't yet to see it, Simon, to watch it. But Al Pacino at one point goes, "If you're gonna make mistakes, make them big. I don't give a fuck." That's one of his lines. And Edmonds at that made a big fucking mistake, but. Who cares, man? He was going for the knockout blow. I'm not going to kill him for that. It was on Hayden. Hayden broke on the pass and was well out of position because he played that ball. He played that exactly the same as he played the one before we got the pick. So you win one, you lose one.
No,
it didn't matter in the game.
I got to disagree with you on this, Gav. I mean, not with the Hayden stuff. The Hayden stuff may well be correct, but with the Edmonds side of it, I mean, his job as the safety is to be the safety valve on that play, right? The last thing you want him doing is charging in 100 miles an hour, just trying to, for some reason, blow up a huge hit on Hollywood Brown for no reason when we're like, you know, what was it, 12 points up in, I don't know, we're up two touchdowns up in the game, right? The game was safe pretty much, as long as he didn't score an 80-yard touchdown.
If he'd have hit him there, you would have been dancing on the spot.
Of course I would, right? Yeah, but he didn't though, Gav. Like, I mean, yeah, of course I would have, right? Who wouldn't? Yeah, if he'd have laid a huge hit on Hollywood Brown, that would have been great. But you've got to be confident that you're going to time that right and do it if you're going to do it. You can't come charging in from halfway.
Thought he was. For every great, amazing play Polamalu, he used to miss a few things here and there. That's just the nature of it.
It was, isn't it?
You either make a million small mistakes or you make one monumental one occasionally and then you make some big splash plays. Give me the splash plays. Give me the big mistakes and the big hits.
I don't know.
Give me that. Rather than the, you know, the mundane, just nothing.
It's just a bad look for a guy who's been so great at tackling all year and he's got such great vibes after last week.
Give him a bly, as the Jamaicans would say. Give him a pass.
He's got a pass, but, you know, come on. Think about game situation for a second. I don't know, Rich, am I being too harsh?
Yeah, I think a little bit. But, you know, I remember the play, but I only saw it once and I really didn't analyze who had the... a responsibility there, but yeah, I mean, it was one of those things, you know, there's only one guy in position to make that tackle too, when you think about it, you know, until he was tackled. So that's a problem in itself.
And it's Hollywood Brown, man. I mean, that was his calling card, wasn't it? Making guys miss.
I don't think he even did anything. I think he just ran straight line. I think it's just flew sideways.
Little something.
Minka, I thought Minka was also kind of up and down a little bit. He dropped an easy interception. You can't get on him too much for dropping an interception. That's why he's not a wide receiver. But that's a play that he would normally make, I think. I mean, it was as easy as they come.
What about the walk-off pass breakup on your guy?
Well, he does.
Yeah, the touchdown breakup was one of the plays of the game. That was pretty impressive.
I was literally up walking to the toilet, thinking, oh god, they scored a touchdown, and then what? Oh, they didn't score, because
I almost missed that because as I saw the ball sailing towards that long haired dude lumbering in the end zone, I thought, oh, there you go, that's a touchdown. Oh, an amazing play.
All right. No. You keep picking one play a game from everyone that you like and writing off the rest of the game.
What do you guys think?
Sorry, Rich.
No, that's great. What do you guys think, though? I mean, that's typical Harbaugh right there. I mean, if it's me, I spike the ball and kick the field goal. You know it's going to be a close game. You're playing the Pittsburgh Steelers. Harbaugh knows that as well as anyone. But that's him, man. That's his ego going for it. But what do you guys think? Would you guys have done the same play? Would you have tried for the touchdown?
Yeah, I might do. I might have done. Yeah. I just think, yeah, division game. You know,
I'd have spiked the ball either way, right?
Yeah.
I don't know why.
Well, you're trying to catch them, you know, trying to catch them off.
Yeah, you're just trying to just catch a quick one, aren't you?
They almost got it, to be fair. I mean, that was a great, like you say, in fairness to Minka, that was a great breakup, but they almost had it. To Luke Wilson, no less.
Yeah.
So,
who's more of a blocking tight end, but that, hey, you have your best tight end out. What are you going
to
do?
I think we could do with a Luke Wilson, to be honest. I've made this point. I think Minka also, the reason I say this, he jumped out to me on tape, was the RG3 run, the long one, the 40-yarder or whatever it was. Don't know what he was doing on that play. Just kind of similar to the Edmonds thing. He just came charging in and ran straight into a blocker on kind of one of these frantic, lunatic plays that let him sort of run for 40 yards anyway.
Yeah, it is hard again.
It's a hard game. It's hard.
And it's hard without the All-22 as well to really to know what the story is, apart from a few plays where they show up in a positive or negative light. So it's difficult to know.
This was difficult because this week what I tried to do with us having very little time was go and pick out some of the key, because there was a lot of them in this game, right? Kind of key highlight plays and re-watch those a few times to try and understand, just from the angles we have on the TV tape, who was causing a major issue on these plays. And I actually struggled with that long RG3 run because I felt like there was nobody in a position to make a tackle, but then I just kind of saw Minka running in out of nowhere in the corner of my eye. You almost don't notice him on first watch when you watch it on TV because he's nowhere near RG3, but just makes a weird pursuit angle. But anyway, you know, that was the longest run. That's the only reason I bring that up, and that contributed most of RG3's yardage in the game. The DBs, though, you mentioned, played great. Nelson had a lovely open field tackle, although apparently he's now out with a knee injury. I don't know how serious it is. He's not practicing. But a good game from him and Hayden, I thought.
Yeah. Hilton was a bit quiet, I thought. And Sutton was also equally quiet and absolutely duped to death by Justice Hill, which was... it looked like that was... And to me, that was worse than the Edmonds one. Because at least Edmonds committed. Sutton just got smoked in the open field. Better days ahead for those guys.
Yeah.
I think. And Sean Davis showed up in the old run stop. He did manage to stop RG3. So maybe you want the mundanity. You know, you want more Sean Davis.
I can't believe how like much Gav is putting this Edmonds play in the plus category. Can you, Dave? Like, who'd have thought it? Like, we've come into this recap, and the hill that Gav's going to die in is that play from Edmonds is the best play of the game.
When I watched that in real time, it was almost like he just fell flat on his face. It wasn't like he even was anywhere near him to tackle him. Yeah, he just sort of fell down.
Anyway. Torpedoed. He was like horizontal, about a meter off the ground, just flying straight at him.
Do you remember? Sorry, Dave.
If you're going to torpedo someone, at least get near contact. He wasn't anywhere near. He was about 3 yards off.
I'm not saying it was a good play. I'm saying it was an aggressive play, and he got it wrong. It was a mistake, but I'm not going to kill him for it.
Do you guys remember in 2018 there was that like meme where it was like a guy jumping off a bridge, and then he went into like the galaxy and he floated into space, and it was like, are you too old for memes?
Yeah.
Do you remember this?
That meme might have passed me by.
Do you remember that?
What was that called?
I can't remember the name of it, but I was obsessed with the song for a while. I'm sure someone out there in our average audience age of 40 plus is screaming at the name of this meme at me. But anyway, I thought you could have made
our audience is going to say, "What's a meme?
What's a meme?" Yeah.
We skipped over the linebacker position.
I was going to cycle back to it, but as always, you trampled all over my run through. So,
okay. ahead. Make it right.
No, you go ahead. You've got thoughts on the linebackers. Go for it.
Where do you go? Spillane? He's a garbage man, isn't he? The garbage man can...
I thought you were saying he was garbage man. Like, comment.
No. I wasn't saying that. I'm saying he is the garbage man. You know? He's there taking out the trash.
Ah, I like it.
When you least expect it, he's out there working hard, blue collar, you know? Mm. Crack of dawn, late at night, out there shifting smelly cans. That's what he's doing. And I like it.
I don't know if that good or bad, I'm not sure.
That needs to be a drop. That's your work for this week, Gav. Got to find the garbage man drop. he's doing God's work right now. Leads the team in tackles. We saw a bit of Avery Williamson in this game. Do you see anything interesting out of him?
We did. We saw the good and the bad, I thought. No? We saw the lateral ability.
Mm-hmm.
And we also saw the, I think, what you could describe as the hangover of a New York Jets mentality of possibly giving up on a play. Maybe I don't want to accuse a professional of not trying hard, but it seems a little bit like it was the 3rd and 9, I think, with Justice Hill. And actually, Minka bailed him out again to bring back Minka. Minka saved the day to stop the first down. But so I think they ended up punting. But you did see a little bit lack of want to. Just like, I'm not bothered about tackling him. I'll just kind of run into him. So, maybe, you know, just... But he's got the sight, he's got the agility, he's got the speed. I think he's got potential. He can shed well, you know, in spots. I think it was at the end of the first half. He had a nice drive, and then it was capped with that poor play, and then he was yanked, and we didn't see him again. So I think, you know, I think they'll be watching that play in the facility, going, what are you doing here? What's that play? Sort that one out. You're not on the Jets anymore. You know, you're on a winning franchise.
We're not looking for the numbers.
We played well past the echo of the whistle.
I thought I saw a play where he didn't show much speed at all. Actually, the one RG3 got around the end and he couldn't stop him. RG3 got a first down on the ground, and Williamson just didn't get there in time. So I don't know.
Yeah, it seems like he's good when he's making a play forward to the sideline. But if he has to turn his hips, not so much.
Yeah.
We'll see. I think it's a nice piece to have out there, I think, with you know, obviously with the Bush loss. I think he can cover the sideline better than anyone else on the roster. I have that feeling anyway. Because Spillane and Williams ain't doing that.
Yeah.
What's happened to UG3? Is he injured still? Anyone know? I don't know.
I don't think so.
I don't know.
He's not on the injury report.
Because he was the hope, wasn't he?
Mm. Yeah, he's never got going this season. He's never fallen into favour. We probably can't not mention, although he does it every week, TJ, who was probably the player of the game. Two more sacks, 11 on the year, 3 tackles for a loss. Just continues to be TJ Watt. What can you say?
It's almost like he should get credited for sacks that he creates, where he doesn't actually touch the quarterback. But there's one where he bull rushed RG3, and just RG3, just all he was looking at was TJ Watt coming at him through a defensive an offensive lineman. So he ran into the sack of Cam or whoever it was. Can't remember now. But I feel like that's a sort of missing stat. Is it like QB pressures that lead to stats?
Do you know what the stat is? Do you know what the stat is, Gav? You're exactly right. It's QB pressures, but nobody looks at it. Like, everyone's
but it should be QB pressures that leads to a sack.
Well, that's kind of hard to... Yeah, but... I'm just saying... Sorry.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, if you look at volume, though, and I know it's not what you're saying, Gav, but you can't really do that. If you just look at volume, though, of QB pressures, he's so far ahead, and everyone's desperate to crown Aaron Donald Defensive Player of the Year again, and, you know, for good reason. The dude's ridiculous, but, you know, TJ's... I mean, even
TJ's
on...
TJ's ridiculous, too.
Yeah, exactly. Even on Around the NFL this week, if you listen, Chris Wessling, God bless him, was on, and they were talking about last week's Steelers game, and I think Greg Rosenthal was saying, you know, Aaron Donald should be Defensive Player of the Year, and Chris was like, God, you guys just disrespect TJ Watt so much. Like, he should have got it last year, and he should get it this year. So,
right.
People just, because his sack numbers, they're great, right? But they're not always, they're like combined with Bud's sometimes, and that's the winner, so. Yeah. Mm. Sorry, what are you going to say?
We'll check out this stat I just saw. Most QB pressures this season. TJ Watt is tied for third. Stephon Tuitt is in fourth. Ooh. Bud Dupree is tied for ninth. And Cameron Hayward is tied for 15th. That's good team pressure right there. That's a really impressive stat.
Yeah, consistent pressure. You can't block that if there's people coming in from every angle. Good luck.
Yeah.
And he's way ahead in QB hits, I think. One of those stats. And according to Next Gen Stats, he's way ahead in pass rush win rate, because that's the stat they have. I don't know, man. This dude is insane. He should be Defensive Player of the Year as far as I'm concerned. But anyway, I do worry that sometimes we kind of overlook him because he's the one constant. You know, there's never any question about what a great game. When have we ever come on and said, "Oh, TJ didn't have a great game today"? So
yeah, never. Not been said.
It's never been said. So let's hope it continues. Special teams, a bit of a weird one. Ray finally has the dreaded fumble we were waiting for. I've loved Ray this year. We all have, I think. But his decision making has been a bit off for the last few weeks. I think he's kind of been looking lateral a bit. Maybe that's something to do with the coverage as well. I don't know. But he's been fielding kicks that he shouldn't.
He needs to go to the Ryan Switzer school of calling the fair catch, doesn't he? That was a very poor decision to not call it. I think every Steelers fan was going, why hasn't he taken it? He's a guy that was about, 2 yards away from him as he caught the ball. That was crazy. It was a very poor decision that obviously came back to bite him. And it's set a bad tone for special teams as a whole after that, really.
Yeah, but I like that it was a bad decision, but I like the decision to stick with him as returner. They didn't yank him,
absolutely,
go somewhere else.
100%, yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Boz missed a few field goals this season. We've seen last season he was perfect, right? It seemed. This season, not so much.
I think he was perfect.
Yeah.
He missed the extra point, right?
It hasn't cost. Obviously, hasn't cost the Steelers a game yet, but.
Yeah,
we had that. When was that? When was that year where we got really bad? Was that two or three years ago?
Year before last,
he's faced adversity before, so
yeah.
Hopefully, it's not a problem. I think he's showing that he's got better bounce back ability than he had previously in that season.
Yeah, the last few times it's happened, he seems to have missed an easy kick and then nailed the field goals following it. So. Kind of weird. It's a bit troubling, though. Like you say, that we've seen multiple missed extra points. I don't know what's going on with that, but I haven't dissected it, unfortunately. But I was wondering if there's anything weird we saw with a snap or a hold or anything. But because to miss an extra point by that, it was a pretty bad miss. So I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Any punting dissection?
I was just going to give some credit to Berry. To be fair, I thought he continued to punt well. I think he punted 4 or 5 times, 2 inside the 20, and a very nice long booming 56-yard punt early. So, fair play to him. He continues to play very well and make me look a fool.
Were you admiring Sam? I don't risk saying his last name. Is it Sam?
Sam Koch.
Koch.
Sam Koch.
Koch. Or Koch.
Coke. anyway, you can say it where it doesn't sound like a male sex organ.
Yeah, we don't want to put off the advertisers, Dave.
We have advertisers.
The many advertisers.
All those ones, you know, banging on our door trying to get in here. But he had arguably Ray's fault of a muffed punt and 3 inside the 20. So he had a pretty good day, did old Sam Koch.
Yeah, we've played quite a few good punters this year. It's funny, right? We've had quite a soft schedule. It seems like some of these bad teams often have good punters. So maybe because they get so much practice.
A soft punting schedule. Are you going to do a strength of punting schedule next year?
Maybe I should do that, yeah.
That is something that you can own.
Come out with the 1 to 32 punting rankings.
Yeah. I think this has to be something you should do.
Oh, I don't know if that's something I want to devote time to. I need to distance myself from this punting angle. Okay, should we move on to this game? Anything else? Any sweepy up bits?
No, I think we covered it pretty well.
Yeah.
Despite Ben not really throwing anyone under the bus, Mike Tomlin threw... Everyone under the bus. I said it earlier about I'm not angry, I'm disappointed. He was exactly... if I could adopt a tone as a dad to make someone feel, you know that feeling when your dad was really angry at you, but he wasn't sort of violently angry. He just sort of sat there and was clearly disappointed in you. And I think everyone really felt that. I think if a particular wide receivers don't come back next week with a massive improvement, they've not understood what a big dad move that was of, I am not angry, I'm disappointed in all of you. That was.
Yeah, my dad was never like that. My dad was always either kind of chill, or he would just flip and be quite, you know, violently angry. Not violent, but as in, like, it would be quite visceral. Like, I remember one time when I was in my sort of mid-teens, he'd gone out, him and my stepmom had gone out for something, and I'd stayed in and got, like, I'd stolen gin out of the cupboard and got, like, super drunk and passed out in the bathroom. And he'd come home and I hadn't heard any of this, and he was like banging on the door. I was passed out, and he'd like barged in, like trying to barge the door down. I woke up and unlocked the door, and he thought I was on like drugs or something because I wasn't answering him.
It's classic standard.
He'd gone absolutely nuts. He was like throwing stuff around. I was like scared to death. But yeah, it was only on very rare occasions he would flip out like that. So
sounds a bit like the Kubrick film. What's it called? With the hotel.
The Shining.
The Shining.
Here's Alan. Smashes at the door. Probably not going to be happy with me saying that. Hopefully he's not listening. What was I going to say?
I was going to say one last thing. Tomlin won a challenge.
Yes.
He did. Yeah. He did.
Not had many challenges this year, have we? Actually, when you think about it, I can't really think of any. We had that terrible run where just Tomlin couldn't win a single one. So that was good. Yeah, maybe I think we were calling for, can't we get a rules expert in, someone watching a video, you know, watching the broadcast. Well, the guy on the broadcast says this, I think this, you should throw the flag. Seems to have cleaned that act up, got a quality control dude or something. So that was good.
And speaking of runs, I've got my eye firmly on this sack run now. We're on 68 games in a row, right? Don't want to jinx it a little bit, touch wood, but yeah, I've got my eye firmly on that. What's the record? 69, is it?
Could be.
Record sacks, streaks. What am I trying to say? The number of... I can't get this out of my mouth properly.
If it's 69 streaks
with a sack. Yeah. Sorry, Dave.
If it's 69, we should stop there. Just end there, please, everybody. Just for the joke.
Nice. Sorry. I almost asked Gav this today, actually, but then I realised he was out in a muddy field and didn't need this add into his list of to-do. To go out and find the sound drop of... I was going to find it, but ask him to add it. Of Tomlin just say, when he asked about the receivers, why do they keep dropping it? He just said, you know, it's us sucking. Just stopped. You know, that was a classic Tomlinism. So
that is a good one. Let's get that.
Anyway,
it would behoove us to use that sound drop.
Nice reference to last week. Okay, so that leaves the Steelers with three games to play in 12 days. That was the first one against the Ravens, so two more games in a 12-day period.
That was something I wanted to ask you. Yeah. How do you feel about were you up in arms about this game getting shifted back? Were you angry? Were you tweeting rage? Or were you not bothered? Was it fine?
I think I was tweeting. It's so hard, dude. I'm kind of, on one hand, want to be lenient a little bit to the NFL because what do you even do in this situation, you know? But at the same time, I think there's legitimate questions to be asked about why the Ravens are able to apply such pressure. Because I don't for a second believe... I know everyone's saying, oh, you know, the situations are different, and they are, and I understand that, and that's why Denver had to play with no quarterback because they were at fault and what have you. But we've clearly seen that the Ravens are at fault, and it's almost like they've benefited from being so at fault that they've started a mass transmission. So,
yeah, you're quite right, because that was going to be my point, was that I think I said it before, you know, this season in the pandemic, it's going to come down to how teams handle the pandemic, and they're going to be rewarded or punished accordingly. Well, the Steelers have been punished twice now for other teams' mishaps, and that seems unfair. But then how do you compensate for that? I don't know.
You can't. Yeah, you can't. That's the problem. Like, because I didn't want the game to be cancelled, you know, because all that would mean is if we get, you know, when we get to the playoffs and whatever, it's just going to be an asterisk that everyone brings up, you know, oh, well, you know, they had a game cancelled and the schedule was easy and da-da-da-da-da. So I didn't want that. So what can you do? You know, what can you do? I suppose it wasn't safe. I would have liked for them to have forced them to play it earlier with whatever they had. it felt to me like a stalling tactic from the Ravens, but I don't know. I'm not involved in the conversation, so.
Yeah. Then maybe too, like when we found out it was the Wednesday, I started to kid myself thinking, oh, well, this is justice, you know, like the Steelers lost their mid-season bye. Now they've got their mid-season bye back, or late season bye. You know, let's you know, this is great. We get the players rested up. And then I looked at the upcoming schedule. Oh no, hang on a second. Like, there's now three games, two in prime time, you know, whatever, I don't know. It's tough. So what do you think? I mean, this is a tough schedule. Do you think this you know, what is it, steel is forged in fire or whatever? Does this help the Steelers playoff run, or is this trouble?
I think it might put in, you know, a little bit of jeopardy around the number one overall seed in the AFC, right? Because you've got to look at these next three games against the Washington football team, the Bills and the Bengals, and think, you know, this is a run that on paper might not look particularly tough, you know? I mean, the Bills probably the riskiest game there, but, you know, this is a team that's going to be not out of juice, but struggling a little bit in terms of if we get any health issues, any knocks, any time to prepare. I mean, just looking at this game this week against the football team, they've not played since Thanksgiving. You know, they've had a really long time to rest up.
And team has a really good... They're really good in their trenches, right? Offensive and defensive.
Exactly, yeah. It does feel a bit like a recipe. Yeah, it feels like a recipe for an opportunity for the Steelers to lay an egg, you know, sadly. And I'm hoping it isn't happening.
I'm not worried about the result. I'm just worried about the fact that it's going to be a physical, tough game that they're going to execute. They're going to win the game. I'm confident of that, but it's going to be a tough one against both these lines. You know, it's not the game you want to go up against in a three-game stretch, I don't think.
No.
You know, you want a bunch of pansies out there like the Jets that are just, you know, they don't even want to win. Whereas these guys, they're tough. They've got some players out there.
Well that's know, it. Yeah, I mean, if you looked at this a couple of months ago, or even a month ago, right, you might have said this looked like one of the easiest games on the schedule. But, you know, you look at it now, I mean, this team's a little bit banged up. We're missing two very important pieces on the defensive side, possibly three if Nelson ends up being out for this game. And we're playing a team that, you know, admittedly they're in the NFC least, right, but they look to be rounded into some kind of form.
They could win it. I mean, anyone could win it.
I think they will win it. I mean, every other team in this division looks... Like, they're skating on ice with roller skates, right? Even the Giants have lost Daniel Jones now. They're playing, what's his name? Cody Thingy-Mabob.
Yep, that guy. I wouldn't be surprised if he was their third string. Cody Watson, my bob.
So, I mean, this team, I mean, let's get into this game, right? Let's talk about it. But this team, Antonio Gibson looks fantastic. The running back, she looks legitimately shifty. The rookie, they've got a legitimate wide receiver one with Scary Terry.
Although he's possibly out, right? Is he? He's questionable. Really? Yeah.
I haven't seen that, but okay. Yeah. I trust your wording.
I think that came across the news wire today. So if he's out, see you later. They've got nobody. Who's catching passes from? Yeah. I'm not sure. No names.
I suppose the only plus on the offensive side of the ball for them is that, you know, it's Alex Smith at QB. But even in that sense, you know, if you look at the record with and without Alex Smith. Without him, they were awful. It was like 19 points a game. I've got here 192 passing yards a game. It's gone up to 264 and 27 points a game. So that's a 10-point differential with and without Alex Smith. He's clearly a better option than it was with Dwayne Haskins in there and whoever else, Kyle Allen, was it?
Well, he can play a tight game, for sure.
Yeah, exactly. He can keep it close.
And that's, you know, if he can keep them in it, that's when the damage in the trenches may come, you know. And especially the D-line. The D-line is awesome.
Yeah, the O-line, not so much, right? I mean, they seem to allow...
Good. I mean, it's very good. It's, if you look at the grades on PFF, very good at pass blocking and run blocking.
Okay.
So it's a successful line, you know.
Obviously, the run game is working really well for them, but they are allowing a lot of sacks, so I don't know how much that is. You know, not that I've been studying up on team offensive line tape, but... Yeah, they're averaging over three sacks a game, and they're going up against the best sack team in the NFL right now. So we'll see how that goes. But I think Alex Smith is a guy you can get some pressure on.
Very frustrating though, if you're a Gibson or McKissick owner in fantasy, because you never know which way they're going to go. It seems like Gibson is the better runner but can't pass protect, and McKissick is the better pass protect but can't run.
As a recent Gibson fantasy owner, I'll tell you, it is not frustrating. It's like sitting on a one of those, what's it called, one of those little things where you lie down. It's only got like a, it's like a sofa but with only one side, and people feed you grapes.
Futon. Oh, a chaise lounge.
A chaise lounge. Thank you. Yeah, I, you know, I'm not one of these fancy Hollywood types like Rich. I haven't got one of those. So. And that's just for Vader, right?
I reckon they look good. So your team looks good, but actually you're pretty uncomfortable.
Yeah, they don't look very comfy, those chaise longs.
Nice. And they're ready to collapse at any moment. You think? So that's what I reckon about it. Yeah, the team running game.
Yeah,
they need to commit to Gibson, basically, is what I'm saying.
I think they have done a little bit.
Metaphor. Because McKissick's, you know, he's all right. But yeah, but that's the problem. You come into the NFL in your rookie season, you're not going to be a great pass protector. That's what's going on with Gibson. And he's a converted wide receiver. I mean, yeah. Why that, you know, you want to get that guy out on third down, but yet, you know, you put him out there in pass protection, your QB's getting blown up, so you can't do that. So they're in a bit of a bind. I reckon he'll be great next season. And I'm glad I've got him in a dynasty league. But
of course you do.
Of course I do.
Can I just put in very quickly? Rich, I want you to go out and buy a chaise longue, please, but like a really small one. And then I want you to do a photo shoot with Vader.
All right, I'll get right on that.
Thank you.
That's a very specific request there.
Yes, it is. Well,
that's great Instagram content, right? I'm assuming Vader has his own Instagram, Rich?
You know what? I'm going to open up one up for him. I'll let you guys know. You guys, I'm sure, will want to follow Vader, as he's a very interesting dog.
It's famous, international dog. Not many dogs are known internationally. Vader is.
He's been one of the better guests we've had on this show, I think.
Yeah, he's been good today, though. He's just laying here peacefully, just watching me.
That's a massive insult to the guy's name who we can't remember.
Not remembering his name is the biggest insult. Not Vader being his better.
We'll get Gal back on one day, and then we'll see if he takes over Vader for the number one spot.
Is Gal's bark worse than his bite? I'm not sure.
the opposite side of the ball, right, for the team. The team. I think that's where the stiff competition is. I think you've mentioned it right. The law offices of Chase and Sweat will no doubt threaten to end the Steelers' no sack allowed streak for four games.
Don't forget the other guys, though. Jonathan Allen having a seriously good season. And Tim Settle from I think was he at Alabama, but that dude as well. That's a monster line.
Mm. Yeah, D line looks scary this year. I doubt it's a game where our run game gets going. I don't think this is going to be the game to do it. I don't know.
No, this isn't the get right game for Connor and Co.
Yeah, definitely not. I think Pouncey will still be out, right? By the looks of it,
is Connor gonna be back?
I think Connor might be out.
Is he still gonna be on? I think he's probably, because it's 10 days, isn't it? That you've got to be, if you're diagnosed with COVID, you've got to be out for 10 days. So I don't think he's going to be back. Well, I might be wrong. Then maybe there's definitely some sort of workaround they've got. Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
I think
this
What about Tuitt?
Yeah.
That will hurt with their running game. That could hurt.
Mm. Yeah.
It's a bit of an underrated defense all around, I think, right? I mean, even the pass defense has been good. I think the whole team's under 200 yards a game on pass defense, on passing yardage. So it's kind of a weird, plucky team. So
I think the Steelers will blow through the doors of that. But
you think? Depends if you can catch a ball. But
when you look at just by points per game, like between week one and week five, the game up about 32 points per game. And then after that, they're giving up 17 points per game. Mm. So it's been a big... They've stepped up big time and they've really made those big improvements, you know? And considering that we're... whether this is the yips or it's sort of a wide receiver meltdown going on, it's a bit of a concern. You've got to be concerned, right? There's a... You can't go. I don't think any Steelers fans go into this thinking, "Yeah, we've got this in the bag. We're taking this home." You know, before we even got there.
Yes, this is like the. See, I'm going back to memes again, but this is like the Kermit the Frog meme, right? Where I'm the guy in the hood, the Kermit in the hood, and I'm like asking Dave to join the dark side. Pick against the Steelers, Dave. I'm not actually going to do that this week, by the way. I'm on the positive train. But do it, Dave. Join me.
I'm too much of a homer, I think, for that.
Rich, how you feel about this game?
I feel good about it. I think we'll win. Smith's a pretty heady quarterback. He's pretty smart, and we usually have more trouble with those guys than we do with the athletic quarterbacks. So anything could happen. And they're playing good football right now. We had a little stumble with the Cowboys, but they blew them out recently. But I think we're going to stay undefeated after this game.
Okay, move to 12-0.
And Alex Smith isn't the Alex Smith of old. He's not the elusive, almost Big Ben kind of guy. He's not elusive anymore. You can get him pretty easily. But when you go and a guy has a whole new leg pretty much implanted on him after he's lost half of it, he's not going to be very elusive anymore, to be fair. Not to take anything away from Alex Smith, because he's clearly overcome the odds to come back and even be playing professional football. But he's not...
new leg.
Keep singing it.
No, a whole new scramble quarterback for the Washington football team.
UK Steelers podcast, best singing voice 2020 goes to...
I think I've sung on this podcast twice now. Don't know what's going
on. That's twice more than anyone else.
Yeah. sorry, Dave, I interrupted you.
I'm glad you did. That was a very nice rendition. I was enjoying that. I had me light right and everything. No, he's not the Alex Smith of old. I don't think you can come into this thinking that he's going to be extending plays and what have you. I think he's going to be hit a fair few times and be put on his back quite a bit. I don't think he's going to be doing anything too crazy.
Yeah, that's what I'm betting on, is hoping we can get some serious pressure on him. I think you can force mistakes. He is interception prone this season as well. So, with our secondary being up for some turnovers, we're a strong turnover team and a strong pressure team. I think we can, hopefully, that's the key to success here.
The keys to victory.
The keys to victory with Tony Romo. So let's offer up some score predictions, some bold predictions. Who wants to go first this week?
I'll go first. I think the Steelers are going to win 27-13.
Okay.
I think that it's going to be a grind, and I think the Steelers are going to worry about. I'm worrying about injuries. That's my concern. I think people are going to get pulled with nicks and knocks, and hopefully we get the real win is getting out of this game with any major injuries. And I think the Steelers will hold Alex Smith to zero passing touchdowns. Not the boldest, but that's a prediction.
Would you care to add anything to that for a 2-point gap?
No, I don't. I think that's
happy with the one.
Okay. He's not going to supersize it. He's going to stick with the regular meal.
I think we agree that's a one, right?
Do you want to fill us in? I don't know if you got it in front of you. Did anyone hit anything last week? What was the...
No, nothing. Nothing. Zero.
Did we all get the gauntlet last week?
We all got our gauntlets.
Okay.
And nothing else. Okay. I was fairly close to the score, but outside of the range, unfortunately. Okay. So.
Rich, you kind of expressed cynicism at Gav there. What have you got?
No, I meant he was close to mine.
Oh, sorry, okay.
No, I have it 27-16.
Well, that's not far from me, actually. You've come close to me. It's like battleships.
Yeah, we're all starting to think alike. I know.
We've synced up a little bit. What's your bold prediction?
That Ben Roethlisberger will throw a touchdown.
Excuse me?
That's a one point.
Well, Gav's got Alex not throwing any, so I've got Ben throwing a touchdown.
Hang on a minute. What's going on here?
No, I'll go with, Highsmith is going to prove that he's the future outside linebacker for this team, and he's going to get two sacks and one forced fumble.
Oh, my God. Ooh, he's nailed my prediction. Okay, I had a backup because I actually thought someone was going to pick it, so, okay.
Big Highsmith breakout. You've heard it here first.
Yeah, that's almost verbatim what mine was going to be, Rich. You see, we are syncing up. I was going with the Highsmith trend. Okay,
do you need time?
No. I already had the backup because I had a thought that someone might do that. So I'm going to go Steelers win 28-19. And the backup bold prediction, sorry, Sam Highsmith. I'm going to say that we finally give James Washington a bit of a chance. And the line I've given right now is at least five catches and 75 plus yards. Now, that's for you to tell me, given on where his production has been over the last 10 games.
I mean, that would definitely be a big day for Washington.
Yeah, who normally gets between one and two catches a game.
Yeah. Is it a two-pointer? It feels like a 1.5, so you've done a good job of selecting a decent line. If you'd said seven catches and 100 yards, that would be 2 points, I think.
I think that's right. I don't think that's going to happen.
That's why it's 2 points.
But remember, the line for 2 points is not impossible, Gav.
No, it's not impossible.
It's unlikely.
Yeah. That's a tricky one. I don't know. I don't know what to... I don't want to be the magistrate.
Offer the round table. Take a vote. I'll accept the judge's decision.
You've mastered the skill of skirting the line between one and two. It's just sort of... You're just sort of teasing into it.
I don't know, man. I think people are going to come out and say that's a bold prediction. I mean, this. I don't think he's hit that line at all in the last...
No, he hasn't, to be fair.
Yeah.
I think it's a two.
All right, we'll give him two.
Yeah. We'll give you two.
Got him. Go on, James.
Okay, Dave.
Much akin to how ladies who spend much time together, their cycles sync up.
Uh-oh, it's a Collinsworth move.
29-20.
I've gone for 27-19.
Oh my God, that's one point away from mine.
7-19.
I think we have literally all synced up.
Wow.
And my bold prediction is staying in the Benny Snell fandom. I'm saying he's going to get 120 all-purpose yards and a touchdown.
Oh, and the TD.
Okay, the TD, I think, makes that a two, I think.
That's two.
Yeah.
Okay. So what do we all have as far as pointers? Dave has a two, Simon has a two. What's mine?
You have a two.
Yeah.
A two.
And I have a one.
A one, okay.
Cav's playing it.
Yeah. So three twos and a one, okay.
Because the scores at the moment are...
Just to clarify, it is 120 all-purpose, so not just...
Yeah, all-purpose. All-purpose is clear. Cool. All-purpose is clear, yeah.
That's still a really good game.
At the moment, it's Cy and Rich on 12 points, me and Dave on 9. So this was a very cynical attempt by me to claw back a point.
Can I just say, that's after week 12, and I noticed this week that I won my eliminator. Like, I'm the only person who hasn't gotten a game wrong yet. No, that's not with you guys, that's elsewhere. So is that just, so I've got one point every week?
I know that there is a steward's inquiry, and I need to go back into the tape, and that's going to happen.
Okay.
And it's going to happen when I'm not standing in a field
that's
being
fine.
Rained on.
There may have been a week where...
Sorry, by a vegetable producer. Anyway, carry on.
There may have been a week early where maybe I didn't realise what I was doing yet and deviated and picked the Seahawks. I don't know. But in my eliminator, the Seahawks are still there. But you got some time, because I don't think I'm going to pick them for a while anyway. Well, so.
You picked against the Steelers at least once, maybe twice, and that's where the difference is.
No, this is the eliminator. This is the gauntlet, though, like the picking, you know, the eliminator challenge.
Oh, I thought you were comparing total points.
I'm just saying that I think that's where all my points have come from is purely
that. Oh, gotcha.
Because I've got 12 points in 12 weeks, and I don't think I've picked wrong yet because I won my Eliminator League this week.
Oh, okay.
Beg to differ, but sorry, I did mean to do it. It was on the top of my priority list, but...
That's okay. There's no rush.
I don't want to bore the listeners with my life troubles, but it's been an expanding foam of negativity. Right, so let's do our picks. I'm going to go with the Chiefs because, again, I needed layups. And
you
have
the Chiefs still? Wow.
I've got the Chiefs and against the Broncos, who maybe not will be able to field a quarterback. Let's see. But I think if there's any a gimme, that's a gimme. So give me the points. So next, who's up next?
Yeah, I'll go. I think I got quite lucky last week, right? I was a bit concerned with the Saints last week and nobody else picked them in my Eliminator League. And I ended up nailing it because there was no quarterbacks playing in that game. So... I'm going to go with the obvious one this week, and hopefully that doesn't bite me in the ass. The Raiders over the New York Jets.
You have not picked the Raiders.
The okay. Raiders.
Raiders. Okay, who's next?
You say the Raiders, and it's still the tactic of whoever's playing the Jets.
I haven't followed that every week.
I'll go next then. I'm taking the Cardinals over the Rams.
Wow. Ooh, okay. Okay.
Just because I have no faith.
Can we get a line?
Bad news. You picked the Cardinals in week 5.
Oh, Dave.
How did I?
Yes, you did. Do you need some time to reconsider?
Maybe.
Rich?
Raiders.
Guys are so predictable.
That's why me and Rich are the lead in this competition.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. I just can't have it that we're all... I see that. I see the Jets. I think, I'm not going to pick the Jets. I'm not going to pick against the Jets. I know I'm going with a Patsy, but I'm going with a different Patsy. Just to make it, you know...
Make it interesting. The Chiefs. The thing is, though, Gav, now, after 12 weeks in, I've gone perfect so far. I like the Steelers. Am I in the perfect season now? I've never done it before.
You're not perfect.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, you are.
At least in my ESPN Eliminator League, I am. So am I in the perfect season now? I'm only... It might be a bit early for that. Am I in that week 17 game of Patriots v Jets?
The trumpet has capacity to be ironic, as in you're blowing your own trumpet.
I see.
So that's sometimes it gets used in that capacity.
Well, listen, am I in that week 17 game Patriots Jets, and I'm concerned about that because I feel like that might end up being the scrape in the barrel game. But,
oh yeah, the Jets have got a history against the Patriots. That could be that, yeah. And in Week 17 as well, they've had some weird games there.
We'll wait and see, you know, if we even get to that point. But I've been looking ahead this week.
Isn't it nice this season, the Patriots being so shit?
Well, do you know what I enjoyed this week though was that they won, because I said this on the Shank Club this week. We were talking about that game, and I said I've been a little bit worried about the Patriots that they might be bad enough to be in play for a quarterback. And now they're just hovering just under 500, and I feel like they're a little bit out of that now, unless they kind of have major draft capital to trade. I don't know, but
what do you do? What do you do if you're a Bill Belichick? Do you cut ties with Cam, or do you try and work with him in a bit more of an off season?
No, cut ties.
Depends on ties. He's such a good value for them right now. I know he's not playing well, but he costs nothing. I know the rest of the team kind of sucks too, but
and he's not playing well enough to get paid.
Yeah,
it's an interesting one, isn't it?
Depends what else is out there.
Get ready for that trumpet, Gav. Remember in the offseason I said I'm really curious how he's going to fit into Belichick's system? Well, he's not.
Let's see. We'll see. Well, at the end of the season, he might get a trumpet. I don't know. I just think, you know, given time, give him another year there.
Yeah, I don't think so.
You don't think so?
I don't see it.
He doesn't have the arm accuracy for Belichick's system.
He doesn't have the weapons. I mean, who's...
No. No, good point. Yeah.
Who's catching passes there? Myers and Bird? I mean, geez. These guys wouldn't see the field on the Steelers, would they?
No.
No.
No chance.
Wait. No.
And a tight end, who they got? Unknown.
What's his name? The guy we liked.
Assi, he's not producing. And then at running back, I mean, they got Harris. I mean, come on. I mean, that offense, that is a zombie. I mean...
The trouble is with Patriots, like, I kind of view them the same way I look at Man City players in fantasy football, like fantasy soccer football. I refuse to play them because you can never figure out who it's going to be this week. So it's pointless.
It's not even that. It's like, who's going to be a viable NFL player? I mean, it's like... This is the thing. They've had this for a while, where they're a shit team, and they've had Brady just keeping them alive. Remove Brady from that scenario.
But I think that's it's in equal weight credit and detriment to Bill Belichick, because he's the GM. So how has he let it get to this position? But at the same time, look at their record. I mean, they have one of the worst in terms of depth and quality of the roster overall. One of the worst rosters in the NFL, and they're sitting just under 500. So I think they're actually outperforming the quality of their roster. But
they're in a division with the Jets. I mean, that gives you...
Two games, yeah.
And, you know, and the Dolphins, who have been...
The Dolphins have been good.
Yeah, surprisingly good, but still, I mean...
Well, they've had that weak division forever. That division has been like this for a long time. And they've basically had an easy road to the playoffs every year, when you think about it. You know, because they have been definitely the best or one of the best teams in football for a while, but being in that division, man, just made it so much easier.
Yeah, and I deserve the opposite of the trumpet, because I picked the Patriots. I think I lone wolfed the Patriots to win that division, because A, I'm down on the Bills, and B, I just couldn't get it out of my head. I think I was bewitched by Belichick. You know, I just couldn't refuse to accept. Yeah. I thought I was being so smart when I wasn't jumping on that train with everyone else, but anyway, this isn't the UK.
Anyway, Dave's had more than enough time to make his pick. So
I've been waiting. No, I think if I went for the Raiders, I'd be a bit of a hypocrite now, wouldn't I?
Yeah.
After my hit on you.
Jump into the hot tub.
Nice. I think Dave wants a 2-pointer. I like Dave's approach.
Yeah, I try and go for something a bit more risky. Like to live on the edge. If you're living on the edge, you're taking up too much room. I'm going to go for the Vikings over the Jaguars, which isn't particularly risky.
Okay.
But it's one better than the 0-10 or whatever it is now, Jets.
Yeah, I like that. I mean, the Jags are literally trying to tank, so...
Yeah.
Good, and you haven't picked them, so that's a viable pick. Well done.
Cool.
Okie doke.
All right. Cool.
You know what time it is.
Well, it's that time.
Four large dollars, mate.
Everything on them.
Do you want onions on your set?
I do. Plenty onions.
Now, I've got a few things to get to in Kebab Corner this week, and I've got a feeling we've run over about probably 2 hours by now, so I'm conscious of time, so we'll see how much we can get to. This is Kebab Corner, by the way, everybody. This is where we talk a bit of nonsense. I usually sort of come up with something that sort of struck me in the week, and one thing that struck me this week is my son has developed a love of marmalade, much akin to Paddington, who he also loves. And why is marmalade not called orange jam?
Yeah. Why is it just why does it exist? Because it's disgusting.
It's all right. It's bitter jam, isn't it? Basically, it's bitter orange jam.
But you get the worst one where you've actually got a bit of orange peel in it, like a sliver of orange peel. Disgusting. No, thank you.
I love orange. Orange and chocolate is my perfect combo. But marmalade isn't something I choose to spread on my toast. But I don't know.
It's something I associate with my grandma, like with coronation chicken, and yeah.
I can't say I even remember having that. I'm sure I have had it because I have like a visceral idea of not liking it, but I can't. I'm like that for a lot of things. I can't really remember what it tastes like.
Does marmalade exist in the States? I'm not sure. There's I don't remember ever seeing it.
There's no way Rich knows what marmalade is. Do you?
I'm going to say it does. I'm going to say it does.
I have absolutely heard of marmalade. I have never tasted it though. So, but I know it's out here. It is here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Can we do it's a quick
basically States are quite big on preserves, aren't they?
Can we do a quick quiz on preserves that Rich knows or doesn't know?
but yeah, as I said, a few things to get to. So I don't want to spend too much time on marmalade. There was
Piccalilli. That was the thing.
On Twitter, mate. Piccalilli. Yeah, that is another
that's
one.
A very grandma spread.
Yeah.
You get Piccalilli out there, Rich?
It glows in the dark. It's like a savoury
preserve.
That's disgusting.
Yeah.
It's pretty gross.
Yeah.
It reminds me of like kisses off old ladies with hairy chins.
Oh.
That's another story. I'll bring that on next week.
That reminds me of a story I heard today, which I don't think is suitable for a family podcast. Anyway, Karen.
Yes, I put some out on Twitter. I don't know if any of you saw it. A poll or poll. Maybe, is it poll or poll? Do we need a poll on whether it's poll or poll?
I think it's poll.
Poll. I say poll. But on who would be the most wasted by their respective team? Would it be Joe Burrow? Or would it be Matt Stafford, who was obviously already way into his career? But they were both number one picks in their respective drafts.
Sam Bradford, I thought, was my other initial thought when I saw your poll. I thought he maybe would be the clear winner. Sorry, Karen.
But overall, Stafford won by, I think it was 57% to 40-something. I can't remember exactly what it was.
I voted for Stafford, yeah.
I did as well.
But no one gave their opinion. I'd hope that someone would express their opinion, but no one did. And maybe I should have put, show your working on the tweet as well. But I'm wondering if any of you guys had voted, and if you did, what was your reasoning?
I just feel like Burrow still got potential to transcend the situation. Hope springs eternal, whereas Stafford feels like he's been wasted.
Yeah, I've been saying this for years now. Ever since I started watching football, to me, I've been saying, like, the Detroit Lions have been consistently the most boring football team that have been around while I've been watching football. And that's not to say they've always been the worst, right? You know, like, obviously teams have been worse, the Jets and the Jags.
Were you around for the 16-0 season? I mean, 0-16 season.
When was that? I think that was around the time that I started.
That was before that was when they drafted Stafford, because they went 0-16 and then got Stafford, wasn't it, I think?
What year was it? I think it might have been just before... anyway, I think it might have been just before, or around that time anyway. It was very much when I was coming in.
Because they weren't boring in.
But...
they were terrible.
But
what about Megatron? They had Megatron.
Man. I know, that's what I'm saying. They've had great players, but I've just... like, they've always been this, like, 7-9 machine... they're not even interestingly bad a lot of the time. They're just kind of, you know what you're going to get. They're going to finish third in the division because they're better than the Bears and worse than the Vikings and the Packers. They draft horribly. They coach terribly constantly. And it's like Matt Stafford. That's what I'm saying. Like Matt Stafford, like, he's clearly a great quarterback, but I'm just never interested in watching him. You know, I never see a Lions game in prime time and go, oh, I need to see that. Never.
Yeah, who was that interesting coach? Was it Caldwell? They had it was Caldwell. Was he? I thought he was quite interesting for a while. He'd always get like some
9-7 twice, or 8-8 mix ups, 7-9. I can't remember.
Angry shouting on the sideline.
I don't know. I don't know what it is. I just always found them to be the most boring team in the NFL.
Yeah, I really like Matt Stafford. He's someone I'd love to see as a potential in stopgap between Ben and whoever's next. I think I'd love to see him as a Steeler. But anyway, you'd hope at some point that the Bengals would put something around Joe Burrow to give him something, to at least protect the guy rather than kill him every season. You think they'd see what they have in him and decide, oh, we need to do something about keeping this guy alive rather than just let him get beat up every season. Obviously, he's only one season into his NFL career, but they've managed to break him before the season's even over. So that's the Bengals' sort of outlook on Joe Burrow. But you'd hope they do something about it, right? They've got to do something about getting him protected and giving him something as you know, weapons around him and what have you.
You think so?
Yeah.
I mean. They've got into a weird position where they've suddenly got quite a good offense, I think. You look at the pieces the Lions have got. I mean, without turning into the Lions podcast, you know, Golladay, I mean, he's good. Swift, good. Hawkinson, good.
This is what I mean, though. Like,
yeah. Hall and Amendola, solid sort of, you know, pieces. Peterson, you know, okay. He's at the end of his career, but, you know, solid between the tackles runner can do some work for you. You know, you can turn it into a run game if you want. Why is that not working? The defense has been shocking. Mm-hmm. Patricia, you know, Okuda, they drafted to be, you know, lights out corner playing, not producing.
Okuda, Matata.
on that, I'll go on to the next thing. The main thing I wanted to get to, it's been discussed off air, and I think anyone that listens knows that Simon has a massive addiction to Huel, and it sort of is his. I think you'd agree, it's sort of a primary part of your diet, right?
Yeah, I would. Yeah.
It's the most
when I'm being good. Yeah, when I'm being good.
And we'll sort of. I don't know whether you want to see this as an intervention or what, but I kind of want to set you a challenge.
Oh dear.
Because it's been discussed, as I say, off air, that your and this comes from a place of love, man. This isn't me having a go or taking the piss. I'm not being mean about this.
So this comes from
this comes from a place of love, man.
This is your angry dad again, isn't it?
This is my. I'm not angry.
Have you all written letters? Is this where this is going?
I'm not angry. I'm disappointed, Simon. Yeah. I want to set you a challenge, and because I think anyone that listens, you know, we enjoy we love having you as a host, man. You know,
it's collapsed. What noise was?
A tinkling, I think, of my glass. We want to keep you around as a host, obviously. And we, but I'm concerned for your health, basically.
Oh, no.
So I want to set you a challenge. And from our conversations, as I say, off air, you don't seem to have anything.
Simon squirming in his chair.
Yeah,
sorry.
Yeah.
This is what I want. I want the squirming to happen. I'm going to prolong as much as possible.
He didn't sign up for this when he invited Dave onto the podcast.
He doesn't have to accept the challenge. There's no one saying he has to accept it, but I'll be disappointed if he doesn't. And I kind of want to have a consensus on the challenge, maybe a changing of the challenge. But maybe the challenge could be that you have to try or have to eat at least one new fruit or vegetable every week. And you have to have photo evidence of this. Who put that sound drop in? And report back to us on a fortnightly basis on what you've discovered from your experiences. And hopefully we can improve and change your diet and your outlook on health in general.
I love it. I think it's brilliant. I think we need a weekly kebab feedback corner of how was the peach today?
Yes,
exactly. What
do you think of Jackson?
No, this is just it. From what I've heard of our conversations offline, your experience of fruits and vegetables is the pickle
zero.
In the burger.
No, it's more. I hate pickles.
Dear listener, please understand. Simon does not eat vegetable. He is a massive scurvy candidate. He eats pizza and nothing green or red. Or it's just. It's basically brown. It lives on a brown diet of crisps and pot noodle. Yeah. So, you know, we can all get behind this health drive. It's 2021, rest around the corner, New Year's resolution. I think we can all get on board.
You know, this feels like a move that's more suited to when Chloe moves in. You know, I feel like this is something she might force on me a little bit.
Get ahead of the curve, man.
Well, do we need to set up some sort of reward situation? Do we need to do this how we do with dogs? Do we have to have a reward situation of... You know, you get if you do this good thing, you will get this in return. Do we need a carrot on the stick?
Nothing will set up some domestic bliss. Like, look, I'll just knock up some pak choy. There you go. Let's eat that, Chloe. Not here. Have some crisps and a marathon.
I'm currently focusing on a more kind of low calorie intake days. You know, targeting like days where I just eat 1,000 calories and call it quits. It's different, you know. With the lockdown, you know, and the seasonal affective disorder is going to start setting in now. This doesn't feel
we
like
just
the
want
time.
You to eat something that's grown from the ground. That's it.
Yes.
That's the only factor. Something that's grown with sun.
I think Huel is grown photons. From the ground. And then...
No, not Huel doesn't count. It doesn't.
It doesn't even feel like a big challenge, man. It's one. I'm asking for one thing a week. I'm not asking one thing of a day. I'm asking one thing a week that you've not had before, that you've been put off by before. Maybe it's whether it's, you know, for most people it's sprouts or whatever it might be. One thing that you've gone, I don't want to eat that.
Yeah, this sounds simple, but then because I often think this, right, and then I'll go to like Aldi and think, right, what am I going to do? And then I kind of stand around in the veg aisles and stuff, and I look about and I'm like, I don't really know. What I'm doing, or what I want, or what would even be—I don't know.
You're doing it all wrong, man. You need to get rest first, and then head to Aldi or Lidl. Not head to Aldi and Lidl, because if you just go there with no plan, you know, it's like turning up to a football game with no scheme. What are you going to do then? You're going to do nothing. You're just going to run around in circles. You need to turn up with a plan and execute.
But see, this is why the Huel is what it is for me, because at the minute, you know, and this is what I'm saying. This is why I think. Maybe things will get a bit better when me and Chloe are living together. I'm just not a very planned out kind of guy. I would say in lockdown, my organisation and timekeeping is just at an all time low. My body clock is kind of messed up. You know, as soon as work's out the window, and even sometimes with work, I'm like kind of like sleeping during the day a lot, and like doing work at night, and like just all over the place.
what would you need as an incentive from us?
I don't want any incentive. It's you know, listen. Okay, I can accept this challenge. I think we'll see how it goes.
That didn't sound very, non-committal there.
Even if it's fruit, no?
I think I'm pretty good with fruit. I do. I should eat more fruit because I like fruit. Although I feel like fruit has kind of been exposed in recent years. Is it just me who feels that way? It feels like everyone's down on fruit.
I think it's just you.
No, like, as in, like, people aren't impressed by fruit anymore. Everyone's like, oh, fruit's high in this, and you know, nobody's giving you, you know, medals for eating fruit anymore.
I'm telling you, I don't know if any of our listeners are living in London. There is a place in Swiss Cottage in London, well, actually St John's Wood, called Kaiser's. They're plums, man, out of this world. Yeah, I like a plum. Tried many. The plums you get in Kaiser's, you see like people just hanging out on the street eating their plums. You know, you get traffic wardens just walking past eating plums. They're spilling red juice all over their face. Those plums, that's like God's fruit. I don't know. There's just something special about them. Amazing. I don't know where they get them from. Kaiser's very expensive. I think it's Israeli based shop. A Jewish family run. Amazing fruit, best fruit in London. Get yourself down to Kaiser's, have one of their plums. So you need to find a place like that, a special independent greengrocers.
Yeah, I know. My time management is an awful place right now. My life is in an awful place. I'm just a complete mess of a human being.
I feel like I'm putting you on the spot a bit. I feel kind of bad, but at the same time, as I say, it comes from a place of love. We all, you know, us three guys, we care about you. We want you to be healthy and happy, and I think that's a good first step. It seemed like a fair first step as well, to be fair, of just having one thing a week. Or am I wrong?
You're not wrong, Dave. We've been saying it for weeks off air. You've revealed the bunion to the family.
The bunion? What bunion?
The bunion, your diet.
I was going to say, I'd like to point out there's no bunions to the listening audience. There's no bunions.
It's a diet, it's a metaphorical bunion.
Oh, dear. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
I feel bad. It's almost like bullying, but it's bullying with cause.
Yeah. Yeah. Many have tried and failed.
You just need to develop a love of cooking.
Yeah, that's one of the big problems. I just can't be bothered.
But then, you know, at your age, how old are you? 24?
24, yeah. I feel everything's 24. A bit hectic, even though I do very little, you know? Like, I have very little on the docket. I barely go outside anymore. And yet I still feel like I don't have time to do anything. I'm constantly up in the air. Yeah. You know?
I think at your age, I could only make pasta pesto and a spicy chili. And now I can make a plethora of things. So time's still on your side.
You know, in November I left the house
maybe
twice.
We've been a bit harsh.
I left the house twice
maybe
in November.
Been a bit harsh on you.
Where am I getting all this fresh stuff from? I don't leave the house. I haven't, you know.
At your age, all I was doing was smoking weed and drinking beer. Mm. So, you know.
Yeah, to be fair.
Hey, Simon, what about this? Because I don't like to cook either. It's not my thing. But what about just go to the grocery store, grab a bag of spinach and some salad dressing and throw it in a bowl and put some salad dressing on it. And that's a really good, that's a green leafy vegetable. That's a really good vegetable to have. And just do that. Just eat it once a day. And that'll help you tremendously.
It's funny you say that, Rich. That is something I have kind of considered before. Because the thing for me is, I agree with you. I'm totally about the ease of it for me, right? I don't know what I'm doing with a lot of this stuff, but if it's something simple like that, I feel like I kind of get on board with it. So,
and it gets us off your back as well.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's see what we can do. I'll try and post a picture.
Yeah. View it as a right. Okay. This is where I'm going to eat healthy. This isn't a fun meal. I'm not hungry. This is where I'm putting some stuff, some you know, some earth, Mother Nature's goodness into me.
Yeah.
My cells need it.
Okay. I'm going to commit. I just, you know, I struggle to focus on some of these things sometimes. You know, I've got other concerns going on. I'm trying to correct, and sometimes this is.
You know, you think about, you know, a little tablet you can take and the effect that can have on you, whatever that tablet may be, paracetamol, something illegal, you know, you think about that, the strength that tablet has, and yet you dismiss a leaf of spinach as being completely pointless. But what maybe the goodness that spinach has, you know, you eat 10 leaves of spinach, imagine what that's doing to your body. You can't feel it, but it's doing it to on you on a cellular level.
Mm. Okay.
You convinced yet?
Let's move on from nutritional corner. Jesus Christ. Follow the show at UK Steelers Podcast. Follow me at Cy Wrote This. Follow Dave at This Is Dave Hart, Gav at GM Boom Up, and Rich on Instagram at Rich. What is it? Stun? I've given up. Right. Stun underscore Batman. Bye. Right. Very uncomfortable. We'll see you next week. Hopefully, we'll be 12-0. I won't have died from malnutrition. And yeah.
Okay. If you're a fan of the show and you like Simon, hit him up on Twitter and just remind him about his health quest.
Yes. Or don't, alternatively. Just don't do that. That would also be good. Yeah, we'll see you next week after the game against the team. Hopefully at 12-0. Okay, we'll see you later.
Go Steelers.
Cheers, guys.
Bye. Steelers.